two or three terms. And she said publicly to Ward Connerly during the thick of this fight, "Let me tell you why you want to get rid of affirmative action. You're married to a white woman. You want to be white. You have no ethnic pride. You don't want to be black." End of quote. Holy David Duke. So Loving versus Virginia was wrongly decided. The case said in 1967, the Supreme Court struck down anti-race mixing laws that were on the books in southern states. So I guess that the decision was wrongly decided. Let me tell you why you support this proposition. You're married to a white woman. You want to be white. You have no ethnic pride. You don't like being black. And by the way, when she was asked about it by the newspapers the next day, she said, "That's right, I said it, and I don't take it back," and never did. Ran for, got elected to the House of Representatives, never mind a statement made as racist as anything that comes out of the mouth of David Duke or the KKK or the Aryan Brothers. We're going to get into Seattle in just a second, but first, you know, these Hollywood actors, they're always feeling our pain, our meaning black people's pain. Matthew McConaughey, he said in an interview with a former football star about racism and race, because, you know, he's an actor, so I'm sure he's got a lot of expertise about racism and race because, well, he just does. And he said, and I'm quoting, "I came on to have a conversation, hopefully promote more conversation, with the end goal being that we take the time we are in now in to constructively turn the page in history through some righteous and justifiable change." What the hell did he just say? I mean, it sounded wonderful. "I came on with you to have a conversation, hopefully to promote more conversation." Well, if he has a show every day, there'll be conversation, I suppose. "With the end goal being that we take the time we are in now to constructively turn the page in history through some righteous and justifiable change." You have to acknowledge, referring to white people, that there's a problem so that you can take more ownership for the problem. Individually, you have to acknowledge implicit bias. You have to acknowledge that you'll see a black man, and for whatever reason, you'll view them more of a threat than the white man, probably because society told you to. End of quote. So if white people stop doing that, you know, stop viewing black people differently than you would view white people, if you just stop doing that, then we'll no longer have 70% of black kids being born outside of wedlock. We will no longer have a 50% inner city high school dropout rate in some high school. We'll no longer have the problem where many of our high school graduates from the inner city cannot read, write, and compute at grade level. We'll no longer have the problem where about 25% of young black men have criminal records, either having been arrested in jail, on parole, or on probation. We'll no longer have those problems because when you look at us now, white people, you won't see us as threats. So all these problems that really are far more serious will magically go away because we paid attention to how you see us. What did that guy say yesterday? He called me. Very respectful caller. He said, "Larry, there are four things that people say to me that are examples of institutional racism, systemic racism. Can you deal with them?" I said, "Lay them on me." He said, "Redlining." I explained to him that banks are more likely to grant a loan application from an Asian would-be borrower than a white would-be borrower. So if it's racism, how come they're discriminating against white people? Oops. He talked about longer sentences for black criminals. And I talked about the U.S. Sentencing Commission saying that there is a gap, but the gap is for justifiable reasons, end of quote. Their term, not mine, because black criminal defendants have longer records than white criminal defendants, and judges take that into consideration during sentencing. He also said black boys are expelled at greater rates than our white boys. And I said, that's true, no matter the race of the principal, no matter the composition of the school, no matter the composition of the school board, because of behavior. And then talked about job discrimination and how black-sounding names are discriminated against. Yeah, black employers discriminate against them too. And there are also white-sounding names like Penelope and Gertrude that discriminated against. That's it? That's all you got? We're in pretty good shape. I'm Larry Elder.
Larry will be right back. Stay tuned.
This is Albert Mohler for townhall.com. A chilling headline ran over Easter weekend from CNN. Louisville police officers to record license plate numbers of Easter weekend churchgoers. Over the course of this pandemic, I've argued that churches should follow generally applicable shelter-in-place orders, that these orders and guidelines do not violate religious liberty. Indeed, we ought to comply with them out of love of neighbor. But if policies single out churches and religious groups, it becomes an entirely different issue, an unconstitutional violation of religious liberty. Over the course of the last several weeks, some government officials have crossed the line. In the case of Louisville, it took a restraining order from United States District Court Judge Justin Walker to curtail Louisville Mayor Greg Fisher's attempt to prevent even drive-in church gatherings. The judge said, quote, "The mayor's decision is stunning, and it is beyond all reason unconstitutional." Consider this. In America, in 2020, comes the threat that they're taking names and they're taking numbers. It's extremely important that all American Christians take note. And in a hurry. I'm Albert Mohler.
ADF, fighting for those whose religious freedom is being violated. Trending now on the Mike Gallagher Show.
The U.S.-based company Surgisphere, whose handful of employees appear to include a science fiction writer and an adult content model, provided data from multiple studies on COVID-19 co-authored by its chief executive, so far has failed to adequately explain its data or methodology. Harsanyi points out partisans have been rooting against hydroxychloroquine for months now. There's really no other way to describe the manic reaction to a drug that has been widely, though anecdotally, said to have therapeutic value against coronavirus. Politicians have blocked attempts to study the drug. The number of shoddy pieces of journalism surrounding hydroxychloroquine, he writes, is just remarkable. A couple of weeks ago, Biden compared taking hydroxychloroquine to drinking bleach, even though millions of Americans take hydroxychloroquine every day to survive. Well, now we know, according to National Review, that thousands of hospitals around the world relied on Surgisphere data to make determinations about treatment and studies. The World Health Organization, the organization I'm assured we must continue funding, halted clinical trial, right? Well, guess what the World Health Organization has now done? They've reversed course, they've resumed studies, and we very well may learn that hydroxychloroquine is helpful in mitigating the damage that coronavirus does. And if that happens and we've delayed the studies, we can probably thank knee-jerk anti-Trumpism for the delays. Once again, lots of deception going on.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube today. Trending now on the Dennis Prager Show.
So here's the headline, and then I want to read to you the first sentence. New York Times, this is the New York Times headline. New York Times says Senator's op-ed did not meet standards. The subtitle, or the subhead, after a staff uproar, the Times says the editing process was rushed. Senator Tom Cotton's Send in the Troops essay is now under review. I don't even know what does that mean, it's under review. It's an opinion piece. Now listen to the first paragraph, which is a sentence. Executives at the New York Times scrambled on Thursday, that's yesterday, to address the concerns of employees and readers who were angered by
Call the Larry Elder Show now at 888-971-SAGE. That's 888-971-7243. Eldorados, let Larry know what's on your mind.
Mr. Elder, as a well-read and knowledgeable person about our country's history, I ask you this. Have any black Americans ever paid for or contributed to any statues or monuments to show their respect and gratitude to those thousands of white American Union patriots who fought and died to end slavery in this country's 19th century horrific Civil War?
There is a university in Ohio named Wilberforce. It's a historically black university in Ohio, named after William Wilberforce, who happened to be a white man. He led the movement to abolish slavery in the U.K.
Yeah, hey, Larry, this is Rich from Pittsburgh, PA. Hey, about renaming them bases, you know, because the Southern generals and stuff like Fort Pickens, Virginia, and Fort Bragg, North Carolina, blah, blah, blah. Well, I'm okay for renaming them, but only if you name them in consecutive numbered order, like Fort Trump, number one, Fort Trump, number two, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera.
I've often said that in the case of Barack Obama, he has slave owners on his mother's side, very likely slave sellers, or at least he hails from a country where there was a great deal of slave selling on his father's side. So does he owe a check or does he get a check?
Hi, Larry. I was calling about the tearing down the statues and everything. Barack Obama's father's side of the family were slave traders, and his mother's side of the family were slave owners. When are they going to tear down his monuments or change the names of the schools, named after him? You know, if you destroy history, you can't learn from it.
888-971-SAGE, 888-971-7243, Larry Elder, ReliefEcker.com studio. On this Phone a Bro Friday, Mike Lindell giving back. As you know, he's making face masks for hospitals and is distributing them to hospitals for free. He's also offering fantastic discounts on all of his products. Just go to MyPillow.com right now. Click on the radio listener special. You're going to see some fantastic offers. Buy one, get one free on a variety of amazing products, including the Supima MyPillows, the Giza Dream Sheets, the MyPillow Towels, the Roll and Go Anywhere Pillows, the Duvet Covers. Buy Mike Lindell's book, What Are the Odds? From Crack Addict to CEO, you're going to get free shipping and a $25 gift card. So just go to MyPillow.com, enter promo code Larry, or call 800-890-1843. Be sure and use promo code Larry. I was asked yesterday, too, about the discrimination that black people face in the employment market. But you're talking to somebody who for 14 years ran a small company that placed lawyers with law firms and corporations. And so I interacted with human resource people in corporations, Fortune 500 corporations, non-Fortune 500 corporations, law firms. And of course, because I was in that industry, I know people that placed salespeople, that placed executives, that placed other people. I was in the human resource personnel business for 14 years. And all I observed is anytime there was a qualified candidate, if that candidate was a person of color, that candidate always, always, always had an advantage. I never saw that candidate have a disadvantage, other things being equal. Not one time. And I told you before, every corporation I ever dealt with had some sort of officer or some sort of diversity consultant or some damn thing to make sure that we had a diversified employee staff and that nobody felt that they were discriminated against, and they were deathly concerned about lawsuits filed with the EEOC. I remember when I was in law school, one of my roommates was a computer engineering student. And this is in the days where that was really, really rare. And I was just fascinated by what he was doing with these big computers, big IBM computers, and the spreadsheets he would bring and all this stuff. And it was a new, relatively new, we're talking about 1970, 75, 76-ish. And when he graduated from University of Michigan, he was recruited like a high school prep star by colleges. He had his pick, as did one of his studying buddies, who was also a black guy. And the study buddy ended up going to Procter & Gamble, where I believe he had a very long career, retired, and even dedicated a wing or something like that to the engineering department at University of Michigan. He made so much money. And this is in the 70s. You're going to tell me that there's more racism now than there was in the 70s? and a black college-educated couple where both work have for a long time out-earned your average white-educated couple where both work. And if you look, I think I told the gentleman who called, if you look at the unemployment rate for black married men, the black unemployment rate has almost always been twice the unemployment rate for whites. Almost always. However, the unemployment rate for married black men is the same as the unemployment rate for whites. Now, why would that be? Well, because typically the average married guy probably have a lot more responsibility, a lot more concerned about his career, a lot more concerned about her career, investing, growing, building, being more focused, having more responsibility. I don't know. You tell me. But certainly, if it's racism, how can it be that a married black man has the same unemployment rate as a white man? How can that be? And the reason I'm bringing these things up is because the reason people are in the streets is because they feel aggrieved. They've been taught that they should feel aggrieved. And then when you get specifics for what they're aggrieved about, it becomes pretty clear that they've been taught to feel aggrieved. But it's illusory. Why do you suppose people want to come here? To come to an aggrieved country where they're going to be discriminated against because they're black, because they're this, because they're that. Are you kidding? It's the most fair country there's ever been. There's a sociologist who's been at Harvard for decades. His name is Orlando Patterson. He happens to be black and Democrat, supported Obama. And in the 90s, he said America, with all its flaws, is the most fair majority white nation on the face of the earth, provides more opportunities, more advantages for black people than any other country, including all of those of Africa. And I've told you about a 1997 poll that was taken by Time and CNN. So this is not some fringe poll taken by some pro-Republican organization where the media can dismiss it. This is Time and CNN. And they asked black teens and white teens, do you feel racism is a major problem in America? And not too surprisingly, both of them said yes. But then they asked the black teens, do you feel that racism is a major problem, a minor problem, or no problem in your own daily life? Now keep in mind, we're told that black kids are afraid of the cops and the cops are out to get them and all this. 89% said racism was either a minor problem or no problem in my own daily life. In fact, more black teens than white teens said failure to take advantage of available opportunities is a bigger problem than racism. So what are we talking about here? And remember, Obama said we're 90% of the way there. We got to get the other 10%. Don't forget, 10% of the American people believe Elvis is still alive. There's not a whole lot better you can do. I'm Larry Elder.
Larry Elder. All true. All devastating.
Trending now on the Eric Metaxas Show.
Folks, welcome. I'm talking to my friend Dinesh D'Souza. He has a new book out today. It's called United States of Socialism, Who's Behind It, Why It's Evil, How to Stop It. Young people seem always to be the easy marks for this kind of marks, no pun intended, easy marks for this kind of thinking.
That's true. I also think that young people will say the Scandinavian model works, but they don't know what the Scandinavian model is. So the Scandinavian countries, for example, are capitalist in wealth creation. They're socialist in wealth distribution, but they're very careful not to kill the goose that lays the golden eggs. And so you have low corporate tax rates, about 20%, same as in America. You have no minimum wage in most Scandinavian countries. They have no wealth tax, no inheritance tax. You can hire and fire people for any reason. Regulations are less than in this country.
Dinesh, I just have to hit pause for a second. Everything you've just said is stunning. I mean, the idea that they have low corporate tax rates, low wealth tax. I mean, you would never dream that in a country that people think of as socialist, that would be the case. Bernie Sanders is not advertising that.
No, and in fact, Bernie Sanders and Elizabeth Warren want to impose financial transaction taxes on Wall Street. Now, there's no Scandinavian country that goes near this. The second part of it is they say, look, we can have a generous welfare state, but here's the point. Everybody has to pay for it, not just the rich. We're not going to go after the billionaires. The basic idea is if we have a 50% tax rate and you make $60,000 a year, give us 30. So in other words, they tax the middle class.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube today.
America has been doing some soul searching lately. Perhaps you noticed we're examining what's right with America and what can be made better. No other country does this kind of introspection better than us. Some of what we found we don't like and will change. Every life has the right to be treated with dignity and respect. That includes our law enforcement as well as every skin color. We've been through this before in America and we always came out stronger. We will this time too. Our hosts will make sure of that. We are The Answer.
Trending now on America First with Sebastian Gorka.
This is the mayor of Washington, D.C., Muriel Bowser on ABC, who has a problem answering a question. She had giant mural-like graffiti written on the tarmac of a street in downtown D.C., Black Lives Matter, but had nothing to comment on what else was painted there. This is three times she was asked a certain question. Muriel Bowser, ABC Video Cut 5. Play video.
Now they've added the words defund the police, which they say they fear you will now remove. Is that right?
We certainly are very proud of the D.C. mural that we commissioned in our Department of Public Works and local artists installed. It is an affirmative piece of art, a centering piece of art, where people from around the globe have called us and thanked us for acknowledging Black humanity and Black lives in the most important city in the world. And we are very proud of that art.
But will you take out the part that says defund police?
Well, it's not a part of the mural, and we certainly encourage expression, but we are using the city streets for city art.
And in other words, that will go away. You will paint over that.
I actually haven't even had an opportunity.
All across America. The Larry Elder Show.
Hey, Larry, this is about the Seattle takeover that's going on right now. You know, I was thinking in 2016, you may remember, when Ammon Bundy and his guys took over a remote national refuge building up in Oregon. It was intolerable to the left. It was wall-to-wall media coverage, and they ultimately sent in the FBI and the ATF to crack down on those guys, and they ended up shooting and killing one of them. And originally, they were there to protest the arrest of the Hammond brothers. And now, I just, at 11 o'clock California time, I go on to MSNBC, CNN, and there is absolutely zero coverage of what's going on in Seattle. And they've taken over six full city blocks, including City Hall and a police precinct. They've fully taken over, and they have AR-15s. They're stopping and frisking people, asking them for their ID, shaking down businesses for money, all of which is conduct that's worse than the conduct that they are saying police officers engage in all the time. Police officers are not allowed to just stop anyone and ask for ID, and they're not allowed to shake down businesses. But here we are, and nothing from the left, complete silence.
Yeah, hey, Larry, this is John, and I just wanted to say that all those protesters up there in Seattle or Olympia, wherever they are at the Capitol, we can accommodate all their requests. And we have wonderful places around the country that'll that'll take care of all their needs. And they might have to shower every 2 days, but it's called prison. So let's suggest that and see how they like it.
888-971-SAGE, 888-971-7243, Larry Elder, ReliefFactor.com. By the way, a cop can come up to you and ask you for ID. Sure, a cop can do that. You don't have to give it to him, but he can ask. I told you that about the time I got arrested, a cop asked me for ID. I didn't have any. He said, why don't you have any? I said, I'm not operating a motor vehicle. I'm not required to. I'm walking. This isn't the Soviet Union. And it went to DEFCON 1 from there. I ended up going to jail. My prints are on file. Mugshot, the whole thing. Probably use it against me when I run for office. Well, I got it out already. It's called a preemptive strike. If I could do it over, would I? Well, I mouthed off, and it escalated it. You know, that's what happened. And I just didn't like the way the officer spoke to me, and, you know, I had a toot, and, you know. How did I get on that? We're going to get into Seattle, what's going on in Seattle in just a second. But I just want one more thing I want to say about this business about racism. I remember when Oprah Winfrey launched her show. And for some reason, she was given a spot on 60 Minutes. This is before the show even launched nationally. She was a regional success, I think in Baltimore. And I watched 60 Minutes pretty religiously in those days. Every Sunday I watched it. I don't anymore, but every Sunday I did. And you didn't have all the alternative channels you have right now. And so there was a big tune-in factor to watch this black woman, overweight, who was as charismatic as anybody had ever seen on television, leap out of the screen. I forget who the correspondent was. That's how fixated I was on her. And the last thing that I recall in this interview, I only saw it one time, so I'm doing this from memory. He said, "How do you see your future?" And she said, and I quote, "My future is so bright it blinds my eyes." End of quote. And it became, as you know, probably the most successful talk show ever. Now, the reason I mention this is because when you're at home by yourself, you have your remote control, you are 100% in control of who or what you want to watch. You don't have to watch her if you don't want to. You're by yourself. You don't have to prove that you're not biased by watching a show hosted by a black woman, which is very unusual in those days. You don't have to do that. You are complete, 100% in control of whether or not you want to pick up that remote and tune her in. Just as when you are in that voting booth or at your home filling out your absentee ballot, you don't have to fill it out for Obama to prove that you're not bigoted. Yet Oprah Winfrey became the most successful talk show host, daytime talk show host, arguably ever. And the country is what, 13% black? So but for a huge tune-in factor by non-black viewers, this could not have happened. You saw her audience. When I watched the show, it didn't seem to me that her audience was largely a black audience. Barack Obama? You didn't have to vote for him. You were 100% in control of how you wanted to vote, no matter what you told the pollsters, no matter what you told your neighbors. So if America is bigoted, it's racist, how does this happen? Now, when your life is in chaos, your home is your safe haven, your most valuable asset. Imagine losing your home to some online scammer. In an instant, you have no place to live, and your home, your security, your nest egg isn't even yours anymore. The crime is called home title theft, and the FBI calls it one of the fastest growing crimes. That's why I urge you to get Home Title Lock. The title to your home is online now, where thieves can find it, believe it or not. Forge your signature on a quitclaim deed. Now it appears you sold the home. They'll borrow against your home, leave you with the payments. Why go through the hassle of attempting to get your bank and insurance company to protect you when you can get Home Title Lock and sleep easy at night? Avoid this nightmare with Home Title Lock. Go to HomeTitleLock.com and register your address to see if you're already a victim. Use code Larry for 30 free days of protection to get you through the crisis. That's Home Title Lock, code Larry. Home Title Lock, use code Larry.
You're listening to The Larry Elder Show.
This coming November, you'll have a chance to make a difference. If you vote, you can save this country from the crazies on the left. You know, the ones that want to ruin the economy, turn America into a socialist utopia.
Like that'll ever work.
But it all starts with one simple act. Make sure you're registered to vote. If you aren't, you're part of the problem. If you vote and you make smart decisions, you'll do more than just make a difference. You'll save the country. We are the answer.
This is Owen Strand for townhall.com. A call is going out now for the dismantling of the Minneapolis Police Department. The president of the city council said this when asked about what to do in the case of a break-in.
Yes, I mean, I hear that loud and clear from a lot of my neighbors. And I know, and myself too, and I know that that comes from a place of privilege, because for those of us for whom the system is working, I think we need to step back and imagine what it would feel like to already live in that reality, where calling the police may mean more harm is done.
There's no doubt that our cities and communities need restoration, including greater peaceful engagement between police and citizens. Yet the idea that wanting protection is privilege is not sound. In fact, it's absurd and won't restore anything. Police who act unjustly are accountable to the rule of law and must be. But there is no need to qualify what a society without police will look like. More harm will surely be done. May coming days bring greater safety and meaningful restoration. I'm Owen Strand.
ADF, fighting for those whose religious freedom is being violated.
If anybody doubted how strong America is, look at all we've been through in the past few months and understand why we're still standing. We're still standing because we believe in the bonds that bring us together. We believe in freedom and liberty. And we believe that after all we've been through, nothing can defeat us. So let's cheer as America gets ready to rebuild and remake our lives bigger, stronger, better than ever before. Keep it here to find out how we are the answer. Trending now on the Mike Gallagher Show.
This is a good country. This is a good and decent land. And I believe that with all of my heart. That doesn't mean we can't do a lot better. But it doesn't mean that a sizable percentage of America is bad. Evidently, former Vice President Joe Biden and the Democrat presidential nominee thinks a pretty sizable portion of America is bad. He had a town hall yesterday, another one of these virtual town halls. It feels like every time Biden goes off script, he gets in trouble.
Larry's father, Staff Sergeant Randolph Elder, says hard work wins. You get out of life what you put into it. And now, here's Larry Elder.
Yeah, Larry, I hear they've kind of taken off, gone with the wind off the movies, and they're doing all the kinds of other things that they seemed are offensive. Well, these were made years ago. And the other guy that lost his job, you know, the guy from the basketball thing that says all lives matter, seems to me this is a form of book burning, and taking away anybody's free speech should not be allowed. You should be able to say whatever it is that you want to say. I may not always agree with you. You may not always agree with me, but you got the right to say it.
888-971-SAGE, 888-971-7243, Larry Elder, ReliefFactor.com studio. You'd think that even the people on the left would be appalled by what's going on. Editor of the New York Times, publishes an op-ed piece written by Tom Cotton. He's no crazy, flaming senator, reflecting the majority of the American opinion, which is that if we don't get control of our streets, we're going to have to send in the National Guard. That's all he said. 800 staffers, New York Times, so ticked off, the editorial editor who approved that op-ed piece resigned. Philadelphia, a similar editor of an editorial page, resigned after being criticized over a headline he approved about a story about buildings being burned. The headline had a line, all buildings matter. Uh-oh, that's racist. That's insensitive. He's gone. I would think even people on the left, even the ACLU types, would be hopping mad at this. Whatever happened to Voltaire's, the statement that is often attributed to Voltaire, although he didn't say it. I disagree with what you say, but I will defend to the death your right to say it. Somebody else said that, you know, this is what Voltaire felt like and wrote it, and people attribute that to Voltaire. But when I used it in one of my books, because they always ask you to source everything, I found out that no one can attribute that to him. But it's a standard line on the part of the left, on the part of anybody that believes in free speech, left or right. And here you have these people being shut down simply because they've made innocuous decisions like that. The reason people are in the streets is because the George Floyd thing has morphed into inequalities in American society. I will remind you of the early days after Obama got elected. Even people that did not vote for him were proud that the country could set aside its past and vote for somebody irrespective of that person's color, even if we didn't like his ideology. And the newspapers were full of stories with black women and black men and saying, now for the first time, I can tell my child that he or she can really grow up to be anything he or she wants to be. I used to say that, but I never really believed it. But now I do. What happened to that? Did I just dream it? This man from Hawaii that nobody knew, whose name nobody could pronounce, decides to go up against Hillary, who was the person that everybody assumed was going to get the nomination in 2008. Qualified, had been first lady, had been senator from New York, had been reelected, had served as Secretary of State. All the different countries she traveled around. Husband of Bill Clinton, one of the most skilled politicians I've ever seen. Comes out of nowhere, gets the nomination, and beats an experienced World War II veteran who had been in prison for 5.5 years in the Hanoi Hilton, and beats him. And then on re-election, even though we had a tepid recovery, despite all the promises because of the taxing and the spending and the regulations, that depressed the recovery, didn't accelerate it because he's a left-wing guy, didn't know any better. What are you going to do? He gets reelected against an experienced politician who had been a former governor, who had run the Olympics. Mitt Romney, and beats him. And now we're having discussions about institutional, systemic, structural racism. Never mind, the data show the opposite. What is going on here? This is nuts. One of my favorite documentaries of all time is something called Hoop Dreams. And this filmmaker followed around these two young black kids who wanted to be professional basketball players. Started following them around when they were in middle school. So over years, this documentary was done. And these two kids were dedicated to basketball. They weren't dedicated to their studies. And they understood the relationship between how much time they put on the basketball court and how good they were going to be as a basketball player, but did not seem to understand the same thing in the classroom. Studies show that black kids study less, put less time in homework compared to white kids, and far less time compared to Asian kids. Now, you understand the connection between hard work and working on your jump shot or your free throw, but you don't understand the connection between hard work and math and science and English and history. This is nuts. This is nuts. A smaller percentage of blacks graduated from high school than years ago, decades ago, when clearly things were more racist. This is nuts. And have all these anchors on CNN, MSNBC, hee-haw, all intoning about racism. What president hasn't talked about racism? Remember when Bill Clinton, at the end of his term, put together this advisory and traveled all around to listen on a listening tour about racism? And Obama gave that speech after the revelation of that crazy pastor he had for 20 years on racism. Did that cause kids to start doing their homework? This is nuts. All these successful black people on television, Van Jones, Don Lemon, Craig Melvin, how'd they get there? Busted their butt, competed in a very difficult industry. Got to show up and work hard every day to survive in that industry. And what do they sell? You're a victim. I'm rich and I'm black, they say to their non-rich black viewers, but racism holds you back from becoming rich and black. How incredibly hypocritical. Kent in Arkansas said, I've been taking Relief Factor for about 3 months, and I'm amazed at how much my pain has decreased. In rainy weather, I would be in ridiculous pain and just wanting to crawl in bed and cry. At this writing, it has been raining all day, and I feel just fine. Before Relief Factor, I never had a day when something didn't hurt. Now, most days, I have great quality of life. I consistently take 3 packets a day, and I do not mind the extra expense. It's much better than pain. Thank you, Relief Factor. How about you? The 3-week quick start is like a trial pack. It can be at your door in just 2 to 3 days. Over 70% of the people go on to order more. ReliefFactor.com, ReliefFactor.com, 800-583-84, 800-583-84.
Live in the pain-free ReliefFactor.com studios, it's the Sage, Larry Elder. Do not leave town.
Trending now on the Dennis Prager Show.
The NFL community and anyone I hurt with my comments yesterday. So who's not included? Friends, teammates, New Orleans, the black community, the NFL community. I guess it. So someone living outside of New Orleans who isn't black and is not part of the NFL community. Okay. In an attempt to talk about respect, unity, and solidarity centered around the American flag and the national anthem, I made comments that were insensitive. Really. It's not insensitive to kneel during the national anthem. It's insensitive to say it's insensitive to kneel during the national anthem. Do you understand what we have come to? You can thank the New York Times, your colleges and high schools, the rest of the media. That's the world in which we live today. Up is down, and down is up. Good is bad, and bad is good. I made comments that were insensitive and completely missed the mark on the issues we are facing right now as a country. They lacked awareness and any type of compassion or empathy. Wow. He really had to grovel. To say that it is wrong not to stand during the national anthem is to lack any compassion or empathy. What if the flag were burned? Let's say an NFL player came out and burned the flag. I'd be very curious to know. Would that be allowed if a black player did that, or for that matter, a white player in the name of Black Lives Matter? Burned the American flag at the open.
Welcome back to the pain-free ReliefFactor.com studios. It's the Sage, Larry Elder.
Thank you for calling 911. Due to the defunding as a result of the marches against police brutality, there are no officers available to respond to your emergency. At the end of this message, please describe in detail why you are calling, and a member of our team will return your call within 4 to 5 business days. Our services now include social workers, therapists, and mediators. For example, if somebody is robbing your house, we will send out a mediator in 4 to 5 days to kindly ask them to stop. If this is a life-threatening emergency, please hang up and ask your higher being to help you.
888-971-SAGE, 888-971-7243, Larry Elder, ReliefFactor.com studio on this Phone a Bro Friday. Speaking of Phone a Bro Friday, we're also going to play Can You Beat Kirk in the third and final hour. The categories this week are lakes, L-A-K-E-S, lakes, classic films, animals, weddings, and popular songs of the 2000s. That will be an audio clue. So stick around for that in the third hour. You think you're strong in the categories of lakes, classic films, animals, weddings, popular songs of the 2000s, and animals, and lakes. Did I mention lakes? Yeah, give us a call at 888-971-SAGE in the final hour of the show. Next hour, I want to play you a video that the LAPD put up after a shooting incident back in April, in which a carotid hole was used on a suspect. Now, it turns out the LAPD got rid of the use of the carotid hold just for restraining, but you can use it in lieu of deadly force if you feel that your life is in danger. And that is what they say happened on April the 17th. And there is audio of the encounter and sound of the encounter. I'm going to play that for you, and you tell me what you think. 888-971-SAGE is the number. Stella is in Menlo Park, California. Stella, you're on the Larry Elder Show. Thank you so much for calling.
Oh, it's so good to talk to you, Larry. I just have to say that I just graduated from Stanford. Well, now it's almost a year and a half ago, but we all call you the smooth operator because we all love that song. I know it's an old song, but that's what we call you.
Wow,
so
thank you.
We all listen to you now. You're very smooth. So anyway, I want to know, because my mother and I listened to you over the holidays. We love, you read excerpts from the book about your father mm-hmm. and your relationship with him. So I want to know, in the wake of everything going on, because he seemed like he had a really good head, he owned a business for years, a restaurant, what would he say about, exactly, what would he say about all this?
Well, Stella, thank you so much for the call. I appreciate it. My father would be appalled. I remember when my father would talk about things going on, and my father used this expression all the time. You know, so-and-so happened when I was your age, quote, now the door is wide open, close quote. He said it all the time. My father grew up in Athens, Georgia, and I asked him one time, Dad, when you walked by University of Georgia, which is located in Athens, did you ever think, maybe someday I could go there? He said, Larry, it never would occur to me to walk by there. It never would occur to any of us to even think about that. We had to eat.
This is Albert Mohler for townhall.com. A chilling headline ran over Easter weekend from CNN. Louisville police officers to record license plate numbers of Easter weekend churchgoers. Over the course of this pandemic, I've argued that churches should follow generally applicable shelter-in-place orders, that these orders and guidelines do not violate religious liberty. Indeed, we ought to comply with them out of love of neighbor. But if policies single out churches and religious groups, it becomes an entirely different issue, an unconstitutional violation of religious liberty. Over the course of the last several weeks, some government officials have crossed the line. In the case of Louisville, it took a restraining order from United States District Court Judge Justin Walker to curtail Louisville Mayor Greg Fisher's attempt to prevent even drive-in church gatherings. The judge said, quote, the mayor's decision is stunning, and it is beyond all reason unconstitutional. Consider this. In America, in 2020, comes the threat that they're taking names and they're taking numbers. It's extremely important that all American Christians take note. And in a hurry. I'm Albert Mohler.
ADF, fighting for those whose religious freedom is being violated.
Trending now on the Mike Gallagher Show.
The U.S.-based company Surgisphere, whose handful of employees appear to include a science fiction writer and an adult content model, provided data from multiple studies on COVID-19, co-authored by its chief executive, so far has failed to adequately explain its data or methodology. Harsanyi points out partisans have been rooting against hydroxychloroquine for months now. There's really no other way to describe the manic reaction to a drug that has been widely, though anecdotally, said to have therapeutic value against coronavirus. Politicians have blocked attempts to study the drug. The number of shoddy pieces of journalism surrounding hydroxychloroquine, he writes, is just remarkable. A couple of weeks ago, Biden compared taking hydroxychloroquine to drinking bleach, even though millions of Americans take hydroxychloroquine every day to survive. Well, now we know, according to National Review, that thousands of hospitals around the world relied on Surgisphere data to make determinations about treatment and studies. The World Health Organization, the organization I'm assured we must continue funding, halted clinical trial, right? Well, guess what the World Health Organization has now done? They've reversed course. They've resumed studies. And we very well may learn that hydroxychloroquine is helpful in mitigating the damage that coronavirus does. And if that happens and we've delayed the studies, we can probably thank knee-jerk anti-Trumpism for the delays. Once again, lots of deception going on.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube today. Trending now on the Dennis Prager Show.
So here's the headline, and then I want to read to you the first sentence. New York Times, this is the New York Times headline. New York Times says Senator's op-ed did not meet standards. The subtitle, or the subhead, after a staff uproar, the Times says the editing process was rushed. Senator Tom Cotton's Send in the Troops essay is now under review. I don't even know what does that mean, it's under review. It's an opinion piece. Now listen to the first paragraph, which is a sentence. Executives at the New York Times scrambled on Thursday, that's yesterday, to address the concerns of employees and readers who were angered by the newspaper's publication of an opinion essay by a United States senator calling for the federal government to send the military to suppress protests against police violence in American cities. That's a lie. It's pure 100% lie. The article never, ever hinted at calling for the federal government to suppress protests. It was entirely to suppress violence. There's a big difference. It's a lie. They don't even know when they lie. That's the amazing thing.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube today. We know this is only temporary. We know it can't go on like this forever. We have to keep focusing on the future and get through this thing day by day. But when it ends, the sun will come out. Jobs will start up again. The traffic jam we used to hate will come back. Thank God for cars. So many things we took for granted are going to be so special. We'll get through this because we have each other. And we have this radio station. We are the answer. Trending now on America First with Sebastian Gorka.
We've been told for at least 6 weeks now that the only way that we can come out of this in any semblance of getting back to normal is this V-shaped recovery. We have this precipitous, voluntary drop because we, as you said, we literally shut down the most powerful economy in the world. And as a result, what we need to see is a concordant and analogous, very, very steep recovery. Don't the figures today indicate that V-shaped recovery, you're the expert, Trish, that V-shaped recovery is in fact possible?
Yeah. I mean, I think that's the glimmer of hope, right, that we have right now. And let me tell you, if you can pull that off, Seb, you give people that economic security again, and wow, I mean, he will be applauded for that. If you have the economic security and the physical security, because don't forget, yes, like this is what we're dealing with right now too. You don't have that physical security. If you can give those two things to people, I mean, I think that really affects the middle of the road voter. They want to feel economically and physically secure. So today was a huge win for the president, but more importantly, this is a huge win for America, for every single one of us.
Keep up with what's
888-971-SAGE, 888-971-7243, Larry Elder, ReliefFactor.com studio. On this, Phone It Bro, Can You Beat Kirk Friday? More on this in due course.
Hello, everyone. I'm Josh Rubenstein, Public Information Director for the Los Angeles Police Department. This critical incident community briefing is intended to provide you with information about a categorical use of force, which was a carotid restraint control hold that occurred in Central Division in the city of Los Angeles on April 17th, 2020. You're about to see relevant video footage and learn about other evidence and police procedures related to the case, so you can have a better understanding of what occurred based on what we know right now. The LAPD conducts very thorough use of force investigations, which typically require investigators to interview multiple witnesses, view numerous hours of video footage, and analyze a significant amount of forensic evidence. We're still at the very early stages of this investigation, which can often take up to a year to complete, and our understanding of the incident may change as this additional evidence is collected, analyzed, and reviewed. We also do not draw any conclusions about whether the officers acted consistent with our policies and the law until all the facts are known and the investigation is complete. A word of caution, the images and information you're about to see may be disturbing. When a police officer uses force to arrest a suspect or defend against an attack, it can be graphic and difficult to watch. In addition, there may be strong language used by those shown in the video. Viewer discretion is advised, especially for young children and sensitive viewers.
Hello, I'm Captain Giselle Espinoza of Media Relations Division of the Los Angeles Police Department. I'm going to give you a brief overview of an incident that occurred on April 17, 2020 at around 11:37 p.m. Officers from Central Division's Resources Enhancement Services Enforcement Team were patrolling the area of 5th and Wall Streets when they observed a male they believed to be a named suspect in an assault with a deadly weapon investigation. As officers attempted to detain the suspect, later identified as 39-year-old Wesley Prince, the suspect fled from them and a foot pursuit ensued. Prince led the officers east on 5th Street, then south on San Pedro Street, when he fell while running. While officers were on the ground attempting to take Prince into custody, Prince reached for a handgun that was tucked in his waistband area. That is when one of the officers applied a carotid restraint control hold. With the assistance of responding units, officers were able to...
I should mention the suspect is black.
...to safely recover the handgun and take Prince into custody without further incident. Body-worn video cameras are used by most officers assigned to field duties. They are worn at chest level and capture a general perspective within line of sight from that angle. The angle of the camera prohibits viewers from seeing everything the officer saw and experienced. Upon activation, both audio and video will turn on. However, body-worn cameras have a buffer of video without audio from the previous 2 minutes prior to activation. This feature is designed to capture incidents that occur suddenly where an officer doesn't immediately activate the camera. Here is body-worn video from the involved officers.
Talk to you real quick. Yo, let me talk. On the ground. On the ground. Got a gun! He's got a gun!
Hey, drop that.
Drop the gun!
Drop the gun. Where's the gun?
Where's the gun? Drop the gun!
Let go the gun!
Don't move!
It's in the gate out.
Hey, let the gun go. I'm gonna tase you.
Yeah.
Let it go.
Hold on, grab his arm. Grab his arm.
He's got
grab
a gun
his arm.
In his hand.
Okay. Okay. Your location.
Hey. Is he out?
Yeah.
No.
Let him go.
Hold on. 1 at 21, 1 at 21, your location.
Hey, Lisa, this is the primary flashlight right over the helicopter. Hey, guys, come forward.
Not an easy job, is it? You have to make a split decision, life and death, in a moment like that, with adrenaline going on like that. And then in the calmness of a courtroom, you're accused of homicide. This is from another body cam from another officer.
Oh, go.
So they're showing it from two different perspectives.
FB21, we're still east on Fifth Street, approaching San Pedro.
Sounds like a female officer to me. As I mentioned, the LAPD, the diversity reflects the diversity of the city. I even saw an ad one time where the LAPD was advertising, asking for gay people to apply to the LAPD. I didn't see any transgender one, but who knows?
FB21 South Palm Beach Road from 5th.
Now, this is the part where Elder says this all could have been avoided. Comply. Comply. Virtually every one of these cases would have been avoided had the suspect complied.
Hey, drop that gun! I'm gonna tase you.
Drop it.
Where is it?
It's there. The gun. Let go of the gun.
One of B21's gonna be 4 feet out with the gun.
Don't move.
One of B21's gonna be 4 feet out with the gun.
Just him to get out.
Hey, let the gun go or I'm gonna tase you.
Yes.
Let it go.
Hold on, grab his arm. Grab his arm.
He's got a gun in his hand.
Put his hands behind his back.
Well, we gotta get the other one.
Yeah.
This is amazing how many people it takes to restrain somebody who does not want to be restrained.
Oh, dude.
No, let him go.
Just grab this whole thing. Grab this one. Hold on.
The carotid hold was used on him. And the LAPD says we only use it in lieu of deadly force. There was a policy where it was used before that for restraint. That is no longer the case. And that's pretty much the case in most big city police departments. Yet the people out in the streets are demanding even further restraints. Now, the one argument that they've made that I think is valid is that it's very difficult to fire a bad cop. For the same reason, it's very difficult to fire a bad teacher. So if the same people are willing to figure out a way we can get rid of bad teachers faster, that's wonderful. We get rid of bad cops faster. But the very same people are perfectly okay with essentially allowing teachers, no matter how bad they are, to stay on the job. And you're shocked that the same kind of union attitude prevails with the LA, with the police departments. You tell me whether or not you're willing to get rid of some of the restraints in general on getting rid of public employees. I'm Larry Elder.
America, we have a country to save. And now, here's Larry Elder.
Trending now on the Dennis Prager Show.
The NFL community and anyone I hurt with my comments yesterday. So who's not included? Friends, teammates, New Orleans, the black community, the NFL community. I guess it. So someone living outside of New Orleans who isn't black and is not part of the NFL community. Okay. In an attempt to talk about respect, unity, and solidarity centered around the American flag and the national anthem, I made comments that were insensitive. Really. It's not insensitive to kneel during the national anthem. It's insensitive to say it's insensitive to kneel during the national anthem. Do you understand what we have come to? You can thank the New York Times, your colleges and high schools, the rest of the media. That's the world in which we live today. Up is down and down is up. Good is bad and bad is good. I made comments that were insensitive and completely missed the mark on the issues we are facing right now as a country. They lacked awareness and any type of compassion or empathy. Wow. He really had to grovel. To say that it is wrong not to stand during the national anthem is to lack any compassion or empathy. What if the flag were burned? Let's say an NFL player came out and burned the flag. I'd be very curious to know. Would that be allowed if a black player did that, or for that matter, a white player in the name of Black Lives Matter burned the American flag at the opening of an NFL game? Would we be allowed to condemn that? Would an NFL player be allowed to condemn that? I would say no.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube today.
This is Albert Mohler for townhall.com. A chilling headline ran over Easter weekend from CNN. Louisville police officers to record license plate numbers of Easter weekend churchgoers. Over the course of this pandemic, I've argued that churches should follow generally applicable shelter-in-place orders, that these orders and guidelines do not violate religious liberty. Indeed, we ought to comply with them out of love of neighbor. But if policies single out churches and religious groups, it becomes an entirely different issue, an unconstitutional violation of religious liberty. Over the course of the last several weeks, some government officials have crossed the line. In the case of Louisville, it took a restraining order from United States District Court Judge Justin Walker to curtail Louisville Mayor Greg Fisher's attempt to prevent even drive-in church gatherings. The judge said, quote, "The mayor's decision is stunning, and it is beyond all reason unconstitutional." Consider this. In America, in 2020, comes the threat that they're taking names and they're taking numbers. It's extremely important that all American Christians take note. And in a hurry. I'm Albert Mohler.
ADF, fighting for those whose religious freedom is being violated. Trending now on the Mike Gallagher Show.
The U.S.-based company Surgisphere, whose handful of employees appear to include a science fiction writer and an adult content model, provided data from multiple studies on COVID-19, co-authored by its chief executive, so far has failed to adequately explain its data or methodology. Harsanyi points out partisans have...
Make sure you check out the show on YouTube. Just go to youtube.com/The Larry Elder Show Radio and click on the subscribe button.
Hi, Larry. I'm just wondering how long it's going to take for the decent, normal people of this country to get together and say enough is enough. How many blocks are they going to take, and how many precincts are they going to overrun in Seattle before the people say enough is enough? And it's always left up to somebody else to do the dirty work.
Saw a poll that said 64% of Americans oppose the protests going on in the streets. What's up with the other 36%?
Hi, Larry. This is Mike Spokane, Washington. I read Thomas Sowell's book, Black Rednecks and White Liberals, and I think it would be really beneficial to have a discussion of redneck culture as Thomas Sowell proposes it in his book to help us understand how we've gotten to where we are. Thank you very much. Thank you for what you're doing. Keep up the fight, brother.
888-971-SAGE, 888-971-7243, Larry Elder, ReliefFactor.com studio. Now, you've helped build MyPillow into the fantastic company it is today, and Mike Lindell is giving back. He's making face masks and is giving them to our frontline workers at hospitals for free all around the country. He's also offering fantastic discounts on all MyPillow products. Just go to MyPillow.com, click on the radio listener specials, and check out the buy one, get one freeze on a variety of products, including the Supima MyPillow, the Giza Dream Sheets, the MyPillow Towels, the Roll and Go Anywhere Pillows, the Duvet Covers, the Giza Pillowcases, the Bolster Pillows, the Neck Pillows. Plus, if you buy Mike Lindell's book, What Are the Odds? From Crack Addict to CEO, you're going to get free shipping and a $25 gift card. Just go to MyPillow.com, enter promo code Larry, or call 800-890-1843. Again, make sure you use promo code Larry. I want to talk about Seattle and the mayor saying that this is kind of similar to a block party in just a second. But first, we're talking about what do the people in the streets want. The George Floyd death has led to a conversation about inequality in America and about the alleged institutional systemic racism that is still plaguing the country. I'm going to read you a letter I received. Mr. Elder, after a successful career, I chose to complete a graduate degree in clinical mental health. Part of the requirements were to act as a mental health counselor supervised for 1 year. Most of my clients were on parole, probation, or at some stage of the legal process. I learned more about human behavior during that year than at any time in my life. It quickly became apparent that each of my clients, and this is what's important, it quickly became apparent that each of my clients had the unquestioned belief that the only reason that I accomplished anything in my life was because I was white and my rich family and friends had given me whatever degrees, money, and influence I needed. It followed that no matter what they did, they felt they were doomed to a life of mediocrity at best. Their friends and their families shared the same view. No coping skills, no insight, no responsibility, especially no recognition that effort is required in life. I could go on and on and on, but suffice it to say that you can throw money, outreach programs at someone until they commit to making an effort to, but until they commit to making an effort to improve their lives and contribute rather than take, it's wasted. Please don't publish my name. I do not need the backlash. Some years ago, I debated Rob Reiner, the actor and director, on a proposition that he was pushing to put a 25-cent tax on cigarettes, on cigars, and I believe on liquor for childhood development programs. It's called California First. And it passed. And I debated against it with him on television. The only reason he agreed to come to the debate is because he didn't know who I was yet. And after I thumped him, I doubt that I'd ever be able to get him to come on the program again. But he pushed it and was successful. And hundreds of millions of dollars over the last 20 years have been raised for childhood development programs. What has the mayor of LA just done? He's redirected $250 million for childhood development programs for the black community. Now go online and try to assess. It's called California First or First Five. You go online and you try to assess whether or not it's made any difference. I'm looking at all these articles. Here's one. What did California's novel approach to funding early childhood programs achieve? Here's the subheadline, long article. The impact of the First Five initiative, spearheaded by actor-director Rob Reiner, is complicated to measure because of the lack of longitudinal data. What? This is an article that was supported by the University of Southern California, their Center for Health Journalism Fellowship. It's part of a series about First Five, a tobacco tax in California, passed by voters. This was 22 years ago, to fund services for young children from birth to kindergarten age. The article, the argument is that the first 5 years of your life are so important, so impressionable, we need to intervene early. That's why it's called First Five. And studies show that that's true. All this money was raised, all these programs developed. Has it done any good? No. It jacked up the taxes on cigarette smokers, cigar smokers, a disproportionate percentage of whom, by the way, happen to be people of color, for programs to disproportionately benefit people of color. Has it done it? No, it hasn't. You can throw money and throw money and throw money, and it's not like we're not spending money. Since the mid-60s, when we launched the so-called war on poverty, how much money has been spent? Over $20 trillion. That's enough to buy almost all the Fortune 500 and the available farmland in the country. I was at a party some years ago, and I got into a discussion with a judge, happened to be from Harvard. And he was telling me we need to spend more money on education. And I informed him that we already spend more money K through 12 than virtually any other country on the face of the earth. I think the only ones that spend more are Switzerland and Luxembourg. He said, it's not true. I said, Your Honor, this is what I do for a living. Believe me, we do. Went home, got him a few papers, sent it to him. He wrote me a very nice letter and acknowledged he was wrong. How can you be wrong about something like that when you're advocating that we spend more money? Wouldn't you think you'd take a look and find out how much we're spending first before you argue we need to spend more? But no. It doesn't seem to matter. Republicans are accused of being greedy, but Democrats believe that money solves all the problems. 888-971-SAG. The Seattle mayor has likened Chaz to a block party. The Seattle police chief said, I'm not the one who abandoned that precinct. I was ordered to. I'm embarrassed, she said. I'm Larry Elder.
This coming November, you'll have a chance to make a difference. If you vote, you can save this country from the crazies on the left. You know, the ones that want to ruin the economy, turn America into a socialist utopia.
Like that'll ever work.
But it all starts with one simple act. Make sure you're registered to vote. If you aren't, you're part of the problem. If you vote and you make smart decisions, you'll do more than just make a difference. You'll save the country. We are the answer.
This is Owen Strand for townhall.com. A call is going out now for the dismantling of the Minneapolis Police Department. The president of the city council said this when asked about what to do in the case of a break-in.
Yes, I mean, I hear that loud and clear from a lot of my neighbors, and I know, and myself too, and I know that that comes from a place of privilege, because for those of us for whom the system is working, I think we need to step back and imagine what it would feel like to already live in that reality, where calling the police may mean more harm is done.
There's no doubt that our cities and communities need restoration, including greater peaceful engagement between police and citizens. Yet the idea that wanting protection is privilege is not sound. In fact, it's absurd and won't restore anything. Police who act unjustly are accountable to the rule of law and must be. But there is no need to qualify what a society without police will look like. More harm will surely be done. May coming days bring greater safety and meaningful restoration. I'm Owen Strand.
ADF, fighting for those whose religious freedom is being violated.
If anybody doubted how strong America is, look at all we've been through in the past few months and understand why we're still standing. We're still standing because we believe in the bonds that bring us together. We believe in freedom and liberty. And we believe that after all we've been through, nothing can defeat us. So let's cheer as America gets ready to rebuild and remake our lives bigger, stronger, better than ever before. Keep it here to find out how we are the answer.
Trending now on the Mike Gallagher Show.
is a good country. This is a good and decent land. And I believe that with all of my heart. That doesn't mean we can't do a lot better. But it doesn't mean that a sizable percentage of America is bad. Evidently, former Vice President Joe Biden and the Democrat presidential nominee thinks a pretty sizable portion of America is bad. He had a town hall yesterday, another one of these virtual town halls. It feels like every time Biden goes off script, he gets in trouble. Do you believe that up to 15% of Americans are bad people? Is that your view of the nation? If we're going to start categorizing what percentage is good, what percentage is bad, I don't know. That doesn't seem like a winning campaign strategy to me. Here was Joe Biden yesterday. He was with actor Don Cheadle in a virtual town hall.
Do we really think this is as good as we can be as a nation? I don't think the vast majority of people think that. There are probably anywhere from 10 to 15% of the people out there that are just not very good people. But that's not who we are. The vast majority of people are decent. We have to appeal to that, and we have to unite people, bring them together.
That's a heck of a way to unite, Mr. Biden, that up to 15% of Americans are not very good people. What a unifying message. I guess that goes on a campaign slogan. 15% of Americans are bad? Wow.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube today.
Attention business owners. As America gets back to work, we'll come.
Share excerpts of today's show from Larry Elder's YouTube channel. Just go to youtube.com/ The Larry Elder Show Radio and click on the subscribe button.
Hi, Larry. I wanted to call your show to tell you that you have a fantastic show. Love your bumper music. It takes me back in time. The reason why I call is I'm a 63-year-old black woman. I've been Democrat my whole life and my family still is. I decided to give Trump a try. I did. My biggest problem is that Republicans do not fight. I love a fighter. I love Trump because he fights. But I cannot stand Republicans not fighting and standing up for him. Good luck, Larry. Keep doing what you do. Thank you.
The thing for us to remember is that the same crime element that white people are scared of, black people are scared of. The same crime element that white people fear, we fear. So we defend ourselves from the same crime element that they scared of. You know what I'm saying? While they waiting for legislation to pass and everything, we next door to the killer. We next door to him, you know, because we up in projects where it's 80 in the building. All them killers that they letting out, they right there in that building. But it's better just because we black, we get along with the killers or something. We get along with the rapists because we black and we from the same hood. What is that? We need protection too.
888-971-SAGE, 888-971-7243, Larry Elder, relieffactor.com studio. I post new excerpts of my show, from my show, every day on YouTube. I think we put 4 excerpts up there last night. So just go to youtube.com/TheLarryElderShowRadio. youtube.com/TheLarryElderShowRadio. The channel's growing pretty fast.
Thank you, Larry Elder.
And be sure and follow us on Twitter, on Facebook, and on Instagram. Today I was interviewed by Swedish television about what's going on in the American streets. And I was interviewed by the BBC. Same thing. What's going on in American streets, they ask. Well, surely this is because of institutional racism. And I was asked about the movie Gone with the Wind and how I felt about the restrictions and all that stuff. And I said, really? I asked my mom, my dad once, I told them how they felt about it. My dad could barely remember having seen the movie. My mother saw it a bunch of times and loved it. And I said, I consider it to be kind of low priority. I said, and what's the goal? To make sure black people's feelings aren't hurt? The media treats black people like children to whom the truth cannot be told. And if the idea is to make sure black people's feelings aren't hurt, I said, take a look at study after study after study that shows black people have higher self-esteem than do white people. Black boys, black girls have higher self-esteem than white boys, white girls. And black girls' self-esteem is off the chart. They feel much more comfortable about their bodies. White girls tend to be obsessed with a Barbie-like image, not black girls. So if the idea is to make sure that blacks don't feel bad, don't have low self-esteem, mission accomplished, because we don't. In the next hour, we're going to play Can You Beat Kirk? I've got one question from five categories. The categories are lakes, classic films, animals, weddings, popular songs of the 2000s. That's going to be an audio clue. So if you think you're strong in the categories of lakes, classic films, animals, weddings, popular songs of the 2000s, then give us a call at 888-971-SAG in the final hour, where we will be playing Can You Beat Kirk? And also, we'll be playing Phone a Bro More in that in due course. Now, there were riots in the 60s, as you well know, in our cities. There was a really big one in Detroit in 1967. 2,500 businesses were looted. 1,500 buildings set on fire. 43 people killed. 342 people injured. A poll was taken in the aftermath of that riot. And guess what percentage of blacks referred to the looters as criminals? Nearly 70%. And the same percentage felt that violence hurt the cause of civil rights, didn't help it. And we have similar numbers now. New poll, YouGov, Huffington Post poll, found that by a 20-point percentage margin, blacks oppose defunding the police. 49% opposed it, 25% support it. 20-point margin. Most black people know what Tupac knows. Black people need the police living in the inner city more than anybody else. Why do you suppose the police come so often? Why do you suppose there's so much tension? Because of the crime. You think they want to be there for their health? You fish where the fish are. The Seattle mayor is justifying the takeover of six blocks. I'm Larry Elder.
Larry Elder, all true, all devastating.
This is Albert Mohler for townhall.com. A chilling headline ran over Easter weekend from CNN. Louisville police officers to record license plate numbers of Easter weekend churchgoers. Over the course of this pandemic, I've argued that churches should follow generally applicable shelter-in-place orders, that these orders and guidelines do not violate religious liberty. Indeed, we ought to comply with them out of love of neighbor. But if policies single out churches and religious groups, it becomes an entirely different issue, an unconstitutional violation of religious liberty. Over the course of the last several weeks, some government officials have crossed the line. In the case of Louisville, it took a restraining order from United States District Court Judge Justin Walker to curtail Louisville Mayor Greg Fisher's attempt to prevent even drive-in church gatherings. The judge said, quote, "The mayor's decision is stunning, and it is beyond all reason unconstitutional." Consider this. In America, in 2020, comes the threat that they're taking names and they're taking numbers. It's extremely important that all American Christians take note. And in a hurry. I'm Albert Mohler.
ADF, fighting for those whose religious freedom is being violated.
Trending now on the Mike Gallagher Show.
The U.S.-based company Surgisphere, whose handful of employees appear to include a science fiction writer and an adult content model, provided data from multiple studies on COVID-19, co-authored by its chief executive, so far has failed to adequately explain its data or methodology. Harsanyi points out partisans have been rooting against hydroxychloroquine for months now. There's really no other way to describe the manic reaction to a drug that has been widely, though anecdotally, said to have therapeutic value against coronavirus. Politicians have blocked attempts to study the drug. The number of shoddy pieces of journalism surrounding hydroxychloroquine, he writes, is just remarkable. A couple of weeks ago, Biden compared taking hydroxychloroquine to drinking bleach, even though millions of Americans take hydroxychloroquine every day to survive. Well, now we know, according to National Review, that thousands of hospitals around the world relied on Surgisphere data to make determinations about treatment and studies. The World Health Organization, the organization I'm assured we must continue funding, halted clinical trials, right? Well, guess what the World Health Organization has now done? They've reversed course, they've resumed studies, and we very well may learn that hydroxychloroquine is helpful in mitigating the damage that coronavirus does. And if that happens and we've delayed the studies, we can probably thank knee-jerk anti-Trumpism for the delays. Once again, lots of deception going on.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube today. Trending now on the Dennis Prager Show.
So here's the headline, and then I want to read to you the first sentence. New York Times, this is the New York Times headline. New York Times says Senator's op-ed did not meet standards. The subtitle, or the subhead, after a staff uproar, the Times says the editing process was rushed. Senator Tom Cotton's Send in the Troops essay is now under review. I don't even know what does that mean, it's under review. It's an opinion piece. Now listen to the first paragraph, which is a sentence. Executives at the New York Times scrambled on Thursday, that's yesterday, to address the concerns.
Now back to the sage, Larry Elder.
Larry, I think we're living in the Twilight Zone now, because not only has Cops been canceled and Live PD been canceled, they're now coming after Paw Patrol. It's a kid's show on Nickelodeon with dogs. And just because one of them is dressed up as a cop, this show has to now be canceled. This is a crazy, crazy world we're living in, Larry. God bless you.
What about Smokey the Bear? Isn't he a ranger? Man. What about Griff the crime dog? He's got to go. McGruff, he's probably a racist. Probably biting black guys for no reason. 888-971-SAGE. You've got nothing else to do. Sit around and find reasons to be ticked off. 888-971-SAGE. 888-971-7243. Larry Elder, ReliefFactor.com. That's what Jonah Hoffman said. Who's Jonah Hoffman? She joined Apple in 1980, later worked at the spinoff tech company called General Magic, was once a close advisor to Apple's CEO, Steve Jobs. And she has criticized Facebook for not being accountable for some of the harmful effects it has on society. Quote, as I look at Facebook, for example, I keep thinking, are they really that ignorant? Or is this motivated by something? She accused Facebook of, quote, destroying the very fabric of democracy, destroying the very fabric of human relationships, and peddling in an addictive drug called anger. You know it's like tobacco. It's no different than opioids. We know anger is addictive. We know that we can attract people to our platform and get engagement if we get them pissed off enough. So therefore what? We should capitalize on that each and every time, end of quote. The left does. But Democrats do. Peddle victimhood. Peddle anger. Because if you get rid of the idea that black people are eternally oppressed, and black people start looking around and going, wait a minute. Only 3% of kids from Elder's former high school can do math at grade level? Wait a minute. 13 high schools in Baltimore? Where 0% of the kids are math proficient, and there are 5 or 6 where only 1% is? Wait a minute. So between 2010 and 2013, black net worth fell a third? How'd that happen, Elder? Well, it's because the left in 1970 passed the Community Reinvestment Act that asked banks to, you know, see what you can do to extend credit to underrepresented borrowers. And banks said, okay, we'll see what we can do. We can't do anything because we want to make sure that we get our money back. That's why we have lending standards, you know. Along comes Bill Clinton. He sees the CRA and he puts teeth in it. And banks had now a CRA score. And if you don't have a sufficiently high CRA score, we're going to jack you up. You may want to merge. We're going to stop it. You may want to acquire. We're going to stop it. You may want to put ATMs various places. We're going to stop it. And we're going to give you a carrot. They're called Freddie and Fannie. So after you make these subprime loans, we're going to buy them back. Because we think owning a home is just good soup. Canada had no Freddie and Fannie. Canadians don't feel that there's some sort of divine right to own a home. As a result, they did not suffer a housing recession the way we did. It was, as I've said in the past, an affirmative action recession. Banks were forced by carrot and by stick to alter lending standards so that anybody who could fog up a mirror could get a home. Now, if you were renting and you were induced into getting a home because you thought they were going to continue to appreciate, and they did for a long time, but there's always going to be a recession. No one's been able to figure out how you repeal recessions. Business cycle is always going to be with us. And no one knows when the highs and the lows are. Otherwise, everybody would be wealthy. So a bunch of people ended up having homes. And I blame Obama for that. Why? Because when Obama was a private lawyer, he worked for a law firm that filed a class action lawsuit against Citibank on behalf of almost 200 plaintiffs, claiming that they're black and they were being shafted, they weren't getting loans. Never mind that their credit score did not meet the standards to get a loan, but they were complaining they weren't getting them because they weren't black. Sued Citicorp, and rather than deal with this in court because of the black eye, they did as most what most businesses do, which is settle. So all these 183 people got mortgages. Guess what? Virtually every single one of them lost it because they couldn't keep up with the payments. Several of them filed for bankruptcy. There's a reason for the lending criteria. You don't have a bank and not lend to people who are creditworthy because that defeats the whole purpose of why you have a bank in the first place. You're trying to make some money. I'm going to turn down a creditworthy borrower just because he's black. And if that were the case, why aren't community banks popping up all over the place to deal with all this business that the white-owned banks just don't want because they're too stupid? I've even seen studies that show so-called community banks have a higher turndown rate for would-be black borrowers than non-community-owned banks. Probably because they're more thinly capitalized, can afford to take risk even less than the bigger banks can. So it's not true. So what is it you want? What is it you're trying to achieve that won't make things worse? Now, I get the idea that police officers, bad ones, are very difficult to fire. I get that. And I think we ought to make it much easier. Just as I think we ought to make it a lot easier to fire bad teachers. It's the same kind of union bargaining, same kind of government contract unions that are usually supported by Democrats. So you're willing to do that? Let's have a conversation. Outside of that, explain to me what you want. A more diversified police department? New York, LA, got it, still complaining. More police chiefs of color. You have a black female who's a police chief in Seattle. Has it done any good? No. They've still taken over six blocks and are claiming that the police are racist institutionally. Doesn't matter that it's led by a black female now. And she's justifying it, calling it like a block party, the mayor?
So I know it will shock you that the president is perhaps not giving an accurate or truthful picture. We've got four blocks in Seattle that you just saw pictures of that is more like a block party atmosphere. It's not an armed takeover. It's not a military junta. We will make sure that we can restore this, but we have block parties and the like in this part of Seattle all the time. It's known for that. So I think the president, number one, there is no threat right now to the public. And we're taking that very seriously. We're meeting with businesses and residents. But what the president threatened is illegal and unconstitutional. And the fact that he can think he can just tweet that and not have ramifications is just wrong.
Well, the Seattle Police Union president would beg to differ, as would the Washington State GOP chair and the Seattle police chief, who says she did not abandon that police precinct. She did not abandon those blocks. We were told to. All that when we come back. Now, if you're in pain, you want out of pain. Here's one I got from Keith from Washington. I'm 51 years old, and I've always been extremely active, and I play college football, crew, rugby, and lacrosse. Currently, I own and run a family martial arts studio, and I teach 4 to 5 karate classes a day. My body felt like it was basically wearing out. I kept hearing that about the ads for Relief Factor on the radio. I had nothing to lose, so I gave it a try. Wow. I have so little to no pain in my knees and highly reduced pain in my neck. I was able to go forward and get my black belt second degree, and now I'm working towards advanced belts in 2 other disciplines. There is no way I could have done this without Relief Factor. I can now do kicks that I was not able to do before because I had so much pain. ReliefFactor.com, ReliefFactor.com, 800-500-8384, 800-500-8384.
America has been doing some soul searching lately. Perhaps you noticed, we're examining what's right with America and what can be made better. No other country does this kind of introspection better than us. Some of what we've found, we don't like, and we'll change. Every life has the right to be treated with dignity and respect. That includes our law enforcement, as well as every skin color. We've been through this before in America, and we always came out stronger. We will this time too. Our hosts will make sure of that. We are The Answer. Trending now on America First with Sebastian Burka.
This is the mayor of Washington, D.C., Muriel Bowser, on ABC, who has a problem answering a question. She had giant mural-like graffiti written on the tarmac of a street in downtown D.C., Black Lives Matter, but had nothing to comment on what else was painted there. This is 3 times she was asked a certain question. Muriel Bowser, ABC Video Cut 5. Play video.
Now they've added the words defund the police, which they say they fear you will now remove. Is that right?
We certainly are very proud of the D.C. mural that we commissioned in our Department of Public Works and local artists installed. It is an affirmative piece of art, a centering piece of art, where people from around the globe have called us and thanked us for acknowledging Black humanity and Black lives in the most important city in the world. And we are very proud of that art.
But will you take out the part that says defund police?
Well, it's not a part of the mural.
This is Owen Strand for townhall.com. A call is going out.
America, we have a country to save. And now, here's Larry Elder.
You know, Larry, every day I'm amazed at how many really wacky people there are in this great country. So tomorrow's another day. See ya.
888-971-SAGE, 888-971-7243, Larry Elder, ReliefFactor.com studio, on this Phone a Bro Friday. Next hour, we will be playing Can You Beat Kirk, and then later on, we'll be playing Phone a Bro. More on that in due course. Well, one of the people who's not whacked out is the Seattle police chief. Her name is Carmen Best, happens to be Black. Here's what she said about abandoning that precinct.
SPD family, I say that because that is what you are. You are my family. And family is honest with each other. And family has tough times. But in the end, we always remain family. We are all going through one of the toughest times ever in the history of the Seattle Police Department. I know how incredibly difficult these past 2 weeks have been for you and for your families. To say thank you will never probably be enough, but thank you. This department cares about you. I care about you. And although it may not seem true at this moment, your community cares about you. I want to update you all on the situation at the East Precinct. The decision to board up the precinct, our home, the first precinct I worked in, was something I have been holding off. You should know, leaving the precinct was not my decision. You fought for days to protect it. I asked you to stand on that line, day in and day out, to be pelted with projectiles, to be screamed at, threatened, and in some cases hurt. Then to have a change of course nearly 2 weeks in, it seems like an insult to you and our community. Ultimately, the city had other plans for the building and relented to severe public pressure. I'm angry about how this all came about. I understand that my comments in this message may be leaked to the public, but I'm not concerned about that. I stand by what I'm saying. We had solid information to believe that anti-government groups would destroy the precinct once we left, whether through vandalism or arson. As you might have heard, the Seattle Fire Department was nearby to protect the precinct and the entire residential block from a real risk of a large-scale fire. This week, there have been demonstrations, and what I understand were threats against a news reporter on Capitol Hill. There was vandalism to our city streets and our building, but today, the precinct remained standing. No officers were hurt, no force was used.
When we come back, Washington State GOP chair says it was no block party, describes these things as autonomous zones. And by the way, they have barriers, right? Borders? I'm Larry Elder. Do not leave town.
You're listening to The Larry Elder Show.
Attention business owners. As America gets back to work, will customers know you're there? With little warning, the coronavirus attacked our nation and our well-being in ways we never anticipated. The tragic loss of life, unprecedented economic upheaval, and a shattered sense of security has left many individuals and businesses in shambles. While the aftershocks could be felt for months to come, they may not have to. There is hope for an extraordinary turnaround of your bottom line. But will you be prepared for America's grand reopening? All signs point to the biggest business opportunity of our lifetime, coming as early as this summer. A recent survey of local advertisers shows a 10-point jump in the number of local advertisers who plan to maintain or increase their spending. One in four businesses expect to spend more in advertising by the end of June, and more than half expect to restart or surge their spending by this summer. As the numbers forecast increased spending from advertisers across the country, will your message be seen and heard? Will your business benefit from the pent-up consumer demand? Salem Surround is prepared to help you deliver the right advertising message to reach all potential customers wherever they are. Your business can be ready for a post-COVID-19 economy, but the time to act is now. Be at the front of the line as our economy begins to fire on all cylinders once again. For a free assessment of your marketing message and strategy, visit SalemSurround.com or contact your local media strategist today.
Trending now on the Dennis Prager Show.
The NFL community and anyone I hurt with my comments yesterday. So who's not included? Friends, teammates, New Orleans, the black community, the NFL community. I guess it. So someone living outside of New Orleans who isn't black and is not part of the NFL community. Okay. In an attempt to talk about respect, unity, and solidarity centered around the American flag and the national anthem, I made comments that were insensitive. Really. It's not insensitive to kneel during the national anthem. It's insensitive to say it's insensitive to kneel during the national anthem. Do you understand what we have come to? You can thank the New York Times, your colleges and high schools, the rest of the media. That's the world in which we live today. Up is down, and down is up. Good is bad, and bad is good. I made comments that were insensitive and completely missed the mark on the issues we are facing right now as a country. They lacked awareness and any type of compassion or empathy. Wow. He really had to grovel. To say that it is wrong not to stand during the national anthem is to lack any compassion or empathy. What if the flag were burned? Let's say an NFL player came out and burned the flag. I'd be very curious to know. Would that be allowed if a black player did that, or for that matter, a white player in the name of Black Lives Matter burned the American flag at the opening of an NFL game? Would we be allowed to condemn that? Would an NFL player be allowed to condemn that? I would say no.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube today.
This is Albert Mohler for townhall.com. A chilling headline ran over Easter weekend from CNN. Louisville police officers to record license plate numbers of Easter weekend churchgoers. Over the course of this pandemic, I've argued that churches should follow generally applicable shelter-in-place orders, that these orders and guidelines do not violate religious liberty. Indeed, we ought to comply with them out of love of neighbor. But if policies single out churches and religious groups, it becomes an entirely different issue, an unconstitutional violation of religious liberty. Over the course of the last several weeks, some government officials have crossed the line. In the case of Louisville, it took a restraining order from United States District Court Judge Justin Walker to curtail Louisville Mayor Greg Fisher's attempt to prevent even drive-in church gatherings. The judge said, quote, "The mayor's decision is stunning, and it is beyond all reason unconstitutional." Consider this. In America, in 2020, comes the threat that they're taking names and they're taking numbers. It's extremely important that all American Christians take note. And in a hurry. I'm Albert Mohler.
ADF, fighting for those whose religious freedom is being violated.
Trending now on the Mike Gallagher Show.
The U.S.-based company Surgisphere, whose handful of employees appear to include a science fiction writer and an adult content model, provided data from multiple studies on COVID-19, co-authored by its chief executive, so far has failed to adequately explain its data or methodology. Harsanyi points out partisans have been rooting against hydroxychloroquine for months now. There's really no other way to describe the manic reaction to a drug that has been widely, though anecdotally, said to have therapeutic value against coronavirus. Politicians have blocked attempts to study the drug. The number of shoddy pieces of journalism surrounding hydroxychloroquine, he writes, is just remarkable. A couple of weeks ago, Biden compared taking hydroxychloroquine to drinking bleach, even though millions of Americans take hydroxychloroquine every day to survive. Well, now we know, according to National Review, that thousands of hospitals around the world relied on Surgisphere data to make determinations about treatment and studies. The World Health Organization, the organization I'm assured we must continue funding, halted clinical trial, right? Well, guess what the World Health Organization has now done? They've reversed course, they've resumed studies, and we very well may learn that hydroxychloroquine is helpful in mitigating the damage that coronavirus does. And if that happens and we've delayed the studies, we can probably thank knee-jerk anti-Trumpism for the delays. Once again, lots of deception going on.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube today. Trending now on the Dennis Prager Show.
So here's the headline, and then I want to read to you the first sentence. New York Times, this is the New York Times headline. New York Times says Senator's op-ed did not meet standards.
888-971-SAGE, 888-971-7243, Larry Elder, ReliefFactor.com studio. Next segment, we will be playing Can You Beat Kirk? It'll be Dan from Cleveland pitted against Jim from Houston, Texas. Dan, Jim, do not leave town. And then later on in the hour, we will be playing Phonebro. We already have one contestant, Devin from L.A. Devin's looking for an opponent. 888-971-SAGE, 888-971-7243. The mayor has described the takeover of six blocks and a police precinct in Seattle to a block party. To this assertion, here is what the Seattle Police Union president said.
They're willing to take a precinct. Removing the 911 call center won't allow police service in the city. So where is the reasonableness here? Where's the safety of the reasonable community of the city of Seattle? To me, that is absolutely appalling. And I'm embarrassed being a Seattle resident to be even talking about this.
Washington State Republican chair.
Well, it was unlike any block party I've ever been to. As we approach the precinct that has been abandoned, the East Precinct in Seattle has been abandoned since Monday. As we approach that precinct, we actually witnessed firsthand as about a dozen officers attempted to walk through the blockade to come back to work at the precinct. And saw about 100 protesters flock to them, pick up barricades, and physically force them back out of the zone. And so as we're seeing from the mayor, who's saying, oh, this is a peaceful protest at the block party, the police are not supported by the elected officials. They're not allowed to do their job. So they retreated, and that's what you saw in the video we posted on Twitter, is the police load up in vans and move on. The chief of police said yesterday, response times in that area have tripled. When they're trying to respond to a rape call, a murder call, it's going to take them 18 minutes because they don't have officers operating out of what should be a police precinct because it's in this occupied zone where these protesters have just taken over. It's complete lawlessness.
I mentioned I was interviewed by the BBC today, and the person who interviewed me said, I heard your show yesterday. Who was that Brit that went on that rant about political correctness? I said, you don't know? He said, no. I said, he's a comedian. His name is Tom Walker, and he plays a fictional character called Jonathan Pye. And his Twitter handle refers to himself as Jonathan Pye. So, by popular demand, a number of people asked me who it was and wanted me to play it again. Here he is.
Well, it's a beautiful day, so we're up on the studio roof. Today, we're going to be discussing Laura Ingalls Wilder, author of The Little House on the Prairie books, whose name has been removed from a writing award because her books display stereotypical attitudes and contain racial language. I mean, for f***'s sake, I'd be f***ing amazed if they didn't, frankly. These books, they're based on the author's childhood between 1870 and 1894. That's like 5 years after slavery was abolished. The books were written during the Jim Crow laws. It's almost as if cultural norms aren't fixed and changed with the passage of time. Who is this helping? No one. No one needs protecting from Little House on the Prairie. Or, for that matter, the racially charged language of Huckleberry Finn or To Kill a Mockingbird. Or what does this achieve? Who does this help? Stop sanitizing and denying the past to make yourself look good. I'm sick of it. It's utter bull and it's everywhere you look. We live in the most inclusive, progressive, diverse, prosperous society ever in human history, yet we behave as if we've never had it so bad. We're told that there is prejudice wherever you look because there aren't enough female biographies on Wikipedia or enough BAME cyclists on the road. Apparently, the biggest challenge to London cyclists is not safety, it's diversity. We used to react to prejudice. Now we actively seek it out, often where it doesn't exist. Google has taken the egg out of its salad emoji to make it more inclusive for vegans. Is there a single vegan in the world that feels triggered or oppressed or unrepresented by a salad emoji with an egg in it? What does this achieve? Who does this help? My generation, right, we've never really had to fight for much. Gay rights certainly has come a long way in my lifetime, but I mean, we never had to fight for the vote. We never had to fight in a war. You know, my grandmother watched the Battle of Britain taking place above her house. Nazis in planes over her house attempting to invade our country. Actual Nazis. I'm not talking Trump voters. Actual Nazis. Recently, you had Vogue magazine saying tackling women's issues today is harder than women's battle for the vote. You pampered, privately educated... The suffragettes went on hunger strike. Emily Davidson sacrificed her life. Wearing a Louis Vuitton black dress on a red carpet is not the same as jumping in front of a racehorse. Stop demonstrating how worthy you are. And it's not just, look at this, it's everything. It's everything, right? What's this? The pride sponsored Costa Coffee. Who does this help? I'd like a skinny latte, please, with one pump of sugar-free hazelnut syrup. Would you like it in a cup that publicly displays that you're happy with the notion of same-sex couples having the right to... I just want a coffee, mate. It's 6:30 a.m. and in 20 minutes I'm scheduled to interview Amber Rudd. I just need the caffeine. Give me my skinny latte. We don't call it a skinny latte anymore, sir, because that phrase is considered fat-shaming. So I would just then... Peter Tatchell getting arrested in Russia, protesting their disgusting record on gay rights. I'm with you every step of the way. Putting a rainbow on a placemat in Wagamama's. Who is that for, exactly? Or are you just cynically hijacking an entire social movement to promote your chain of restaurants by wrapping your corporate brand in rainbow-coloured virtue to help you sell dumplings? Stop politicising my dumplings! This is just a corporate extension of this modern phenomenon of demonstrating how right on and woke we all are. I see people who define themselves as anti-fascist on their Twitter profiles. Who isn't? I'm sorry, that's the default setting. It's not impressive to be anti-fascist. Imagine showing off about that. I am not a fascist. Good! What do you want, a medal? Not endorsing fascism is about as common as not endorsing fascism. Okay, can we not just work from the assumption that most people, even people we don't like, aren't fascists? Vice magazine recently reviewed the trailer for the new live-action remake of Dumbo and said the trailer was, and I quote, cute and heartwarming and seemingly neither racist nor terrifying. News just in, the new Dumbo film probably isn't racist. What on earth made you think it would be? This is what identity politics does to you. It turns your head into blancmange. You can't see the world how it actually is. You see racism and oppression where there is none. A white girl singing along to Kendrick Lamar doesn't make her a racist. Let's not pretend it does, okay? That executive from Netflix who got fired last week for saying an offensive word in a meeting that was called to discuss the use of offensive words. Welcome to 2018, where context and intent are no longer required to brand your fellow citizens racist. It's madness, and yet it's mainstream. It's normal. The new Star Wars film drew criticism because it doesn't deal with the issue of slavery in a satisfactory manner. Shut up! I'm watching Star Wars! The film Dunkirk was criticised for not having enough women or people of colour in it. It's set in the English Channel during World War II. This is the politicisation of art, which of course is the end of art, and it's everywhere. J.K. Rowling got a pasting from LGBT activists because Dumbledore isn't openly gay in the new Fantastic Beasts film. Is this really the height of the gay community's oppression? I don't for one second believe that it is, but if it is, the war's already been won. Okay, if the worst thing that's happening is a wizard not being shown the elbow, you need it. Chill out. It's all good, mate. Do you really think any normal person, and when I say normal, I mean white, black, girl, boy, gay, straight, and everything in between, you know, normal, do you think any normal person really gives a about this? Anyone normal, they just want to eat their noodles, drink their skinny latte, watch their kids' movie, appreciate old novels written by people with different sets of values to us, and of course speak out against racism and oppression and injustice, but where it actually exists. Because there's a lot of it about. There's a lot of it in this country, but you won't find it in a novel written 100 years ago, or on a picture of an egg, or in a movie about a flying elephant. Crows? What? I've never seen Dumbo.
When we come back, Dan in Cleveland versus Jim Houston. Can you beat Kirk? I'm Larry Elder.
You're listening to The Larry Elder Show.
America has been doing some soul searching lately. Perhaps you noticed we're examining what's right with America and what can be made better. No other country does this kind of introspection better than us. Some of what we've found, we don't like, and we'll change. Every life has the right to be treated with dignity and respect. That includes our law enforcement, as well as every skin color. We've been through this before in America, and we always came out stronger. We will this time, too. Our hosts will make sure of that. We are The Answer. Trending now on America First with Sebastian Gorka.
This is the mayor of Washington, D.C., Muriel Bowser on ABC, who has a problem answering a question. She had giant mural-like graffiti written on the tarmac of a street in downtown D.C., Black Lives Matter, but had nothing to comment on what else was painted there. This is three times she was asked a certain question. Muriel Bowser, ABC Video Cut 5. Play video.
Now they've added the words defund the police, which they say they fear you will now remove. Is that right?
We certainly are very proud of the D.C. mural that we commissioned in our Department of Public Works and local artists installed. It is an affirmative piece of art, a centering piece of art, where people from around the globe have called us and thanked us for acknowledging Black humanity and Black lives in the most important city in the world. And we are very proud of that art.
But will you take out the part that says defund police?
Well, it's not a part of the mural, and we certainly encourage expression, but we are using the city streets for city art.
In other words, that will go away. You will paint over that.
I actually haven't even had an opportunity to review it, Martha.
She surrendered. She's surrendered. That's the mayor of Washington, D.C., three times refusing to say, yes, we will remove the graffiti that says defund the police. Clear enough for you, America? Clear enough for me.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube today. This coming November, you'll have a chance to make a difference. If you vote, you can save this country from the crazies on the left. You know, the ones that want to ruin the economy, turn America into a socialist utopia. Like that'll ever work. But it all starts with one simple act. Make sure you're registered to vote. If you aren't, you're part of the problem. If you vote and you make smart decisions, you'll do more than just make a difference. You'll save the country. We are The Answer.
This is Owen Strand for townhall.com. A call is going out now for the dismantling of the Minneapolis Police Department. The president of the city council said this when asked about what to do in the case of a break-in.
Yes, I mean, I hear that loud and clear from a lot of my neighbors, and I know, and myself too, and I know that that comes from a place of privilege, because for those of us for whom the system is working, I think we need to step back and imagine what it would feel like to already live in that reality, where calling the police may mean more harm is done.
There's no doubt that our cities and communities need restoration, including greater peaceful engagement between police and citizens. Yet the idea that wanting protection is privilege is not sound. In fact, it's absurd and won't restore anything. Police who act unjustly are accountable to
Welcome back to the Larry Elder Show.
Hi, Mr. Elder. This is Mark from Ohio. I would like to know, what are your opinion on the polls? It seems like every poll is showing Trump losing by 8 to 10 digits. I think it's a ploy to try to get people not to come out to vote. What are your thoughts, sir?
My thoughts is it's June 12th. 888-971-SAGE, 888-971-7243, Larry Elder, ReliefFactor.com studio. Mike Lindell giving back, making face masks and distributing them to hospitals all around the country. Also offering great discounts on all of his products. Just go to MyPillow.com, click on the radio listener specials. You buy his book, you're going to get a $25 gift card and free shipping. Just go to MyPillow.com, promo code Larry, or 800-890-1843. Be sure and use promo code Larry. It is time now for Can You Beat Kirk? We've got Dan from Cleveland, Ohio. We have Jim from Houston. I believe Jim has been waiting longer. So, Jim, how are you, Jim?
Pretty good, Ellie. How you doing?
I'm doing great. You have a feisty competitor named Dan from Cleveburg, Ohio. So, look alive, Jim. You have five categories, sir. They are lakes, classic films, animals, weddings, and popular songs of the 2000s, which is an audio clue. Where would you like to start first?
Lakes.
Consider it done. All right. All right, James. As you well know, there are five so-called Great Lakes in America. Give me four.
Michigan, Huron, Ontario, Erie.
Booyah. My goodness. What's the one that you missed? Just for grins.
Well, I didn't miss.
Excuse me, I rephrase the question. What's the other one I didn't ask you about? Superior. Well done. The score is 1-0. James over Daniel. We have classic films. We have animals. We have weddings. We have popular songs of the 2000s, Jim.
Classic films.
In what year was the film Gone with the Wind released?
Nineteen thirty-five.
Okay, Dan, you're in the game, my man. How you doing, Dan?
Larry, it's an honor. It's
Dan,
an honor to talk to you.
Well, thank you, sir. Dan, I'm sorry, go ahead.
Yeah. Reporting for the People's Republic of Ohio in the Cleveland District.
Are you East Side or West Side?
I miss your brother, by the way. He was a great man.
Are you East Side or West Side?
Oh, I grew up East Side, but I'm living on the West Side right now.
Interesting.
I have to give a shout out real quickly to my brother, Khalid Namar. He's my brother in arms.
What's his name?
His name's Khalid Namar. He's also known as the Conservative Sage.
Well, nice.
We met you at a WHK event. The weekend before the RNC.
Wow.
Oh, and by the way, his 10% check is in the mail.
Okay. Well, Dan, you are down love to one. James got the last answer incorrect. The question was, in what year was Gone with the Wind released? What's the correct answer?
1939
it is. The score is now 1-1. Dan has taken control of the board. You have animals, you have weddings, you have popular songs of the 2000s left. The score is 1-1.
Oh, boy. Let's do animals.
A group of lions, Dan, is known as a what? Score is 1-1. The category is animals. A group of lions is known as a what?
I should know this.
A group of lions is known as a what? Score is 1-1.
I don't know. A group? I don't know.
Okay. That is incorrect. Let's go back to Jim. Jim, you've possibly retained control of the board again. The score is 1-1. The question is, a group of lions is known as a what?
It's known as a prize.
It is. The score is now 2-1, and James has seized control. James, we have weddings, we have popular songs of the 2000s, which is an audio clue. I play the clue, you identify the singer.
Audio song.
I'm sorry, did you say popular songs?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Popular songs,
okay.
Sorry.
Here is the clue, and all I need you to do is identify the performer. Score is 2-1.
Mama.
Talk to me, Jim.
Destiny's Child.
Destiny's Child. Okay, let's go back to Dan. Dan, the score is 2-1. You are down 1. Who was that performer?
Oh, boy. You know, I'm not sure. I'm just going to say Beyonce.
Beyonce. No, that's not it. The answer actually is Lady Gaga. So we go back to Jim. He gave the last correct answer. Jim, the last category, the score is 2-1. It's weddings. Are you ready, sir?
Yes, sir.
According to a marriage website called The Knot, K-N-O-T, The Knot, this day of the week is the most popular to have a wedding. What day of the week am I talking about?
Saturday.
Saturday.
Somebody give me an amen.
3-1, Jim. You win the contest. Well done. Can you put Dan on? He's number 1.
Dan, crying in my beer.
Dan, 3-1. Yes. You got smoke, bro.
I'm usually pretty good at these things, but these categories were. I guess I just wanted to call in. I just wanted to do it, and I wanted to talk to you.
Well, did you know? Did you know the marriage question? Did you know the most popular day of the week to have a wedding? Did you know that one?
I knew the marriage question.
Yeah,
that one I knew.
And
songs of 2000 are not my strong point.
Well, you got the Browns to look forward to.
I have a little cultural weakness there in that time.
Well, what? Dan, you got the Browns to look forward to.
Yeah.
What's the story with Mayfield? Is he still the guy?
I think he is. Mm-hmm. I think he's still. I'm praying we still have an NFL season to look forward to. But yeah. It sounds like we will.
Well, Jim, well done, my friend. 3-1, a crushing defeat. Jim, stay on the line. We're going to get your vital information. You'll get a copy of A Lot Like Me, the book about my relationship with my father, and the conversation we had that lasted 8 hours. And he grew from being an ogre to being this amazing guy. From that moment on, we were best friends for the next almost 35 years. All right, I am Larry Elder. Don't forget, Phone a Bro coming up later on. Do not leave town.
All across America, The Larry Elder Show.
Trending now on the Eric Metaxas Show.
Folks, welcome. I'm talking to my friend Dinesh D'Souza. He has a new book out today. It's called United States of Socialism, Who's Behind It, Why It's Evil, How to Stop It. Young people seem always to be the easy marks for this kind of marks, no pun intended, easy marks for this kind of thinking.
That's true. I also think that young people will say the Scandinavian model works, but they don't know what the Scandinavian model is. So the Scandinavian countries, for example, are capitalist in wealth creation. They're socialist in wealth distribution, but they're very careful not to kill the goose that lays the golden eggs. And so you have low corporate tax rates, about 20%, same as in America. You have no minimum wage in most Scandinavian countries. They have no wealth tax, no inheritance tax. You can hire and fire people for any reason. Regulations are less than in this country.
Dinesh, I just have to hit pause for a second. Everything you've just said is stunning. I mean, the idea that they have low corporate tax rates, low wealth tax. I mean, you would never dream that in a country that people think of as socialist, that would be the case. Bernie Sanders is not advertising that.
No, and in fact, Bernie Sanders and Elizabeth Warren want to impose financial transaction taxes on Wall Street. Now, there's no Scandinavian country that goes near this. The second part of it is they say, look, we can have a generous welfare state, but here's the point. Everybody has to pay for it, not just the rich. We're not going to go after the billionaires. The basic idea is if we have a 50% tax rate and you make $60,000 a year, give us 30. So in other words, they tax the middle class.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube today. America,
has been doing some soul searching lately. Perhaps you noticed, we're examining what's right with America and what can be made better. No other country does this kind of introspection better than us. Some of what we found, we don't like, and we'll change. Every life has the right to be treated with dignity and respect. That includes our law enforcement, as well as every skin color. We've been through this before in America, and we always came out stronger. We will this time, too. Our hosts will make sure of that. We are The Answer. Trending now on America First with Sebastian Gorka.
This is the mayor of Washington, D.C., Muriel Bowser on ABC, who has a problem answering a question. She had giant mural-like graffiti written on the tarmac of a street in downtown D.C., Black Lives Matter, but had nothing to comment on what else was painted there. This is three times she was asked a certain question. Muriel Bowser, ABC Video Cut 5. Play video.
Now they've added the words defund the police, which they say they fear you will now remove. Is that right?
We certainly are very proud of the D.C. mural that we commissioned in our Department of Public Works and local artists installed. It is an affirmative piece of art, a centering piece of art, where people from around the globe have called us and thanked us for acknowledging Black humanity and Black lives in the most important city in the world. And we are very proud of that art.
But will you take out the part that says defund police?
Well, it's not a part of the mural, and we certainly encourage expression, but we are using the city streets for city art.
In other words,
post new excerpts of the show on YouTube every day. Just go to youtube.com/The Larry Elder Show Radio and click on the subscribe button.
Hey, Pelosi, we're going to take down those 11 statues because they own slaves. Well, then we need to come to the Napa Valley where your Cabernet winery is because it was built and the vines were cultivated by slaves. So by that rationale, we need to take down your winery and take down those plants based because it was built by slaves.
888-971-SAGE, 888-971-7243, Larry Elder, reallyvector.com studio. What did Thomas Sowell say? Consider slavery was practiced virtually in every corner of the universe. It would be the greatest cross current of money going back and forth. And it won't stop. Asians enslaved Asians. If it weren't for blacks enslaving other blacks and selling them to Arab and European slavers, the black slave trade, Muslim slave trade could not have happened. The European slave trade could not have happened. And as I mentioned, Barbary pirates seized more whites in Europe and took them to Northern Africa than European slavers took blacks out of Africa and took them to the colonies. This thing on? Now, the Can You Beat Kirk contest, I wanted to mention that the song with Lady Gaga was called Poker Face. I got this interesting letter the other day from a gentleman. I get these from time to time. Just so you guys know, this is not a fruitless effort. Oh, I still need one more phone number. Yeah. Let's see. Devin needs an opponent. 888-971-SAGE. Call right now if you want to play phone number. We're going to play 5 sound bites from this week's collection of shows. Whoever can name the 5th and final soundbite wins a contest. It's a last person standing contest. So sometimes the first person who calls might want the opponent to go first, sometimes not. It depends on how you want to do it, but give us a call at 888-971-SAGE to play Phone a Bro. And again, it's a last person standing contest. Whoever gets the 5th and final clue correctly wins the entire contest. Here's a letter I received. Dear Larry, it's from a gentleman named Kurt, K-U-R-T. I'm not sure if you remember me, Larry, but I used to send you hate mail about 15 years ago when you were at another station in Los Angeles. I was so inexperienced and full of leftist hogwash that I learned in graduate school. Then I decided to start a couple of businesses and everything changed. My views on regulation, on taxation, on the minimum wage, on gun control, and so on and on and on. I'm still not a 100% Eldorado, but now I'm around 80%. I've moved to Phoenix last August. It was the best thing I've ever done. Then the riots broke out. I wrote an op-ed and sent it to the Arizona Republic, but they're so left-wing, I doubt they'll publish it. Can I send it to you and maybe you can review it when you get some time? Thanks a million, Larry. A white Black Lives Matter protest went off on a white woman driving a car because the white woman did not answer her question about whether or not she supported Black Lives Matter correctly. Here's what happened.
Do Black Lives Matter to you?
Absolutely.
Do Black Lives Matter to you? Do Black Lives Matter, all right, Karen? White piece of shit, you little f***ing ass. Oh, yeah, you want to go, Karen?
By the way, notice how she called her Karen. Apparently the term Karen is a new term that means a white, privileged, pampered person. You're a Karen. So it's a demeaning term.
Just yes, bitch. Oh, yeah, you want to go, Karen? No! No! Until Black Lives Matter, no life matters!
Black, white, yellow.
That is not our fight! Until Black Lives
Matter. And the woman in the car says to her, Black, white, green, yellow, it doesn't matter. That was not good enough.
No life matters!
Black, white, yellow.
That is not our fight! Until Black Lives mean something to this country! No. No.
She ain't going nowhere though.
She not going nowhere.
Until Black.
What you gonna do? She not going nowhere.
Black Lives Matter.
Black Lives Matter. Black Lives Matter.
Good Lord. I was talking about the achievements of Trump in terms of helping Black people. Ken Burns has worked for 15 years to get a pardon for Jack Johnson. Obama didn't do it. Trump did. And in an interview, Burns refused to give Trump credit, was asked to by this very gentle interviewer, and Burns still wouldn't give him any credit.
You were one of those who were advocating for this this part.
This is NPR.
What's your reaction now that it's a fact?
This is the right thing to do, and I'm just so happy that John McCain, who really led us for a decade and a half in this, is going to live to hear about it. So I'm very, very thrilled at this posthumous pardon, and you have to understand it. Maybe
notice no credit to Trump for signing it until this happens. Listen up.
I think the only third posthumous pardon, all of them African Americans, which tells you a little bit about race in America.
You mentioned John McCain. What about the man who actually signed the pardon, President Trump?
Well, you know, to me, this is something we've been advocating for an awfully long time.
And if you were to watch the interview, Ken Burns broke eye contact, which meant he was fishing around for an answer because he didn't want to give Trump any credit for anything. Honestly. Really? You can't even give the man credit? Well, we've been working on this for a long time. Then why didn't Obama sign it? Now, how about the 3-week quick start? About $1 a day to see if we can get you out of pain. After that, less than the cost of a cup of coffee a day to stay out of pain. Think of it as a trial pack. Over 70% of the people who order the 3-week quick start go on to order more, and it can be at your door in just a couple of days. Let's face it, getting older, exercise, just everyday living can create pain. ReliefFactor.com, ReliefFactor.com, 800-583-84, 800-583-84.
This is Owen Strand for townhall.com. A call is going out now for the dismantling of the Minneapolis Police Department. The president of the city council said this when asked about what to do in the case of a break-in.
Yes, I mean, I hear that loud and clear from a lot of my neighbors, and I know, and myself too, and I know that that comes from a place of privilege, because for those of us for whom the system is working, I think we need to step back and imagine what it would feel like to already live in that reality, where calling the police may mean more harm is done.
There's no doubt that our cities and communities need restoration, including greater peaceful engagement between police and citizens. Yet the idea that wanting protection is privilege is not sound. In fact, it's absurd and won't restore anything. Police who act unjustly are accountable to the rule of law and must be. But there is no need to qualify what a society without police will look like. More harm will surely be done. May coming days bring greater safety and meaningful restoration. I'm Owen Strand.
ADF, fighting for those whose religious freedom is being violated.
If anybody doubted how strong America is, look at all we've been through in the past few months and understand why we're still standing. We're still standing because we believe in the bonds that bring us together. We believe in freedom and liberty. And we believe that after all we've been through, nothing can defeat us. So let's cheer as America gets ready to rebuild and remake our lives bigger, stronger, better than ever before. Keep it here to find out how we are the answer.
Trending now on the Mike Gallagher Show.
This is a good country. This is a good and decent land. And I believe that with all of my heart. That doesn't mean we can't do a lot better. But it doesn't mean that a sizable percentage of America is bad. Evidently, former Vice President Joe Biden and the Democrat presidential nominee thinks a pretty sizable portion of America is bad. He had a town hall yesterday, another one of these virtual town halls. It feels like every time Biden goes off script, he gets in trouble. Do you believe that up to 15% of Americans are bad people? Is that your view of the nation? If we're going to start categorizing what percentage is good, what percentage is bad, I don't know. That doesn't seem like a winning campaign strategy to me. Here was Joe Biden yesterday. He was with actor Don Cheadle in a virtual town hall.
Do we really think this is as good as we can be as a nation? I don't think the vast majority of people think that. There are probably anywhere from 10 to 15% of the people out there that are just not very good people. But that's not who we are. The vast majority of people are decent. We have to appeal to that, and we have to unite people, bring them together.
That's a heck of a way to unite, Mr. Biden, that up to 15% of Americans are not.
Now back to the sage, Larry Elder.
I'm feeling great. I'm ready to go to war right now.
I'm too fast.
Champion from
the
crib.
I'm the king.
Born the
champ.
Born a champ from the crib. Ah!
I'm handsome. I'm fast. I'm pretty. And can't possibly be beat.
I have tussled with a whale. I done handcuffed lightning, throw thunder in jail. Now, you know I'm bad. Only last week, I murdered a rock, injured a stone, hospitalized a brick. I'm so mean, I make medicine sick.
888-971-SAGE, 888-971-7243, Larry Elder, ReliefFactor.com studio, 625 or so. I'll be on Hannity's show again. My foil will be Leo Terrell, the increasingly reasonable Leo Terrell. It is time now, as you heard, for Phone and Bro. We've got John from Minneapolis, Minnesota versus Jason from Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. Jason waiting the longest. He'll get to go first. Here are the rules, gentlemen.
Okay, Larry is going to play 5 sound clips from this week's show, and all you have to do is guess who's speaking. And if you can't guess, then you can ask for a clue. Phone a bro, and you'll get one of my world-renowned clues to help you get the answer.
I said Jason, I think, from L.A. It's Devin from L.A. He's been waiting the longest. Devin, you heard the rules. Devin, you get to go first. Now, a few wrinkles. The first one, as you heard, you cannot use a phone-a-bro on the first one. You have to get that one on your own. And because, Devin, this is the last person standing contest, the person that gets the fifth and final clue wins, irrespective of what happened before that, you can elect to go first, or you can elect to have John go first in hopes that John stumbles along the way and you can swoop in and get that fifth and final clue. How do you want to play it, Devin?
Hi, Larry. Well, first, I'm a female.
Okay.
And secondly, I would like to go first.
All right, you got it. Devin, the female, gets to go first. Here we go, Devin. Soundbite number one. You got to get this on your own.
Way less crime. There's a reason for less crime. That's because we have great law enforcement. I'm very proud of them.
Devin, who is that gentleman?
That is President Donald J. Trump.
It certainly is. All right, Devin, soundbite number two, and this time you can use a phone-a-bro if necessary.
Oh, it's nice to see
Some people changed their mind, the head of the NFL said, yeah, maybe we was wrong.
Who was that gentleman, Devin?
Well, my poor ears, it's Al Sharpton.
It certainly is. Democrat kingmaker Al Sharpton. Never mind about Tawana Brawley. We won't talk about that. All right, soundbite number three, young lady. And again, you can use a phone number if necessary because you haven't used one so far.
Physical separation. And when you get congregations like we saw with the demonstrations, as we have said, myself and other health officials, that's taking a risk.
Devin?
I believe that's Fauci.
That is Fauci. Soundbite number four. We only have two left to go, and your phonobro is still active if necessary. Here we go.
And he's also advanced opportunity zones in the inner city, and he's pushing for school choice for inner city parents. That's to me the civil rights issue of our era.
What do you think, Devin?
Can I do phonobro?
You certainly can. He is our current Attorney General.
Okay, awesome. That's Bill Barr.
That is. Okay, the problem, however, Devin, is that you've exhausted your phonobro, so this is a fifth and final clue, the most important one, and you have to get it on your own. I cannot give you a clue if necessary. Here we go.
The same crime element that white people fear, we fear. So we defend ourselves from the same crime element that they scared of. You know what I'm saying? While they waiting for legislation to pass and everything, we next door to the killer. We next door to him, you know, because we up in the projects where it's 80 in the building. All them killers that they letting out, they right there in that building.
Devin?
Well, I am going to say that is Tupac Shakur.
Is that what you're going to say? Is that your final answer, young lady?
Yes.
Somebody give me an amen.
Woo! Help! Oh my goodness. Put John on, Mr. McConnell.
Sorry.
John, you didn't even get on the court. My goodness.
Ouch. I'm hurt.
That was a beatdown. But you didn't get on the court, I'm sorry, go ahead.
The thing is I knew all the answers too.
Did you know every single one of them?
I knew them all, and Devin, congratulations. Well played.
Did you know Devin was a female?
Thank you.
I didn't, but you know what? She did really well. And by the way, Larry, your show is awesome, and I really love listening to your calm and reasoned statistical approach to things.
Well, John, thank you so much for that. And Devin, very, very well played. You stay on the line, and we will get your information. Extremely well done. Now, Governor Inslee of Washington, no idea about the autonomous zone.
Governor, I'd like to ask you about what's going on in Seattle. There's this thing called the Capitol Hill Autonomous Zone. What's your thought on that? The fact that the protesters have taken that over and not allowing people to come and go freely? Regarding the Capitol Guard.
Well, that's news to me, so I'll have to reserve any comment about it. I have not heard anything about that from any credible source. Not that you're not credible, it's just like before I espouse an opinion, I should know of which I speak.
Really? You're unaware of the seizure of these blocks?
The perimeter stretches from here at 13th Avenue, goes past 11th Avenue.
Governor, I haven't heard anything about this.
Avenue, and it goes from Olive to Pike.
They're doing what?
The protesters we talked with here today say at this point they don't have any plans to leave.
You want to call it anything, it's the people's community.
That's what this protester says. But today, police say they're concerned about safety and their goal is to reopen the East Precinct. According to Assistant Chief Deanna Nolette, they've seen checkpoints where people are armed. And she says, quote, we've heard of people ask for ID and that a business was told they needed to make a donation to be in the area.
Governor, I'd like to ask you about what's going on in Seattle. There's this thing called the Capitol Hill Autonomous Zone. What's your thought on that? The fact that the protesters have taken that over and not allowing people to come and go freely? Regarding the Capitol Guard.
Well, that's news to me, so I'll have to reserve any comment about it. I have not heard anything about that from any credible source. Not that you're not credible, it's just like before I espouse an opinion, I should know of which I speak.
I am white, so I apologize.
Barbaric! Barbaric!
Are you high?
Yeah.
This is Albert Mohler for townhall.com. A chilling headline ran over Easter weekend from CNN. Louisville police officers to record license plate numbers of Easter weekend churchgoers. Over the course of this pandemic, I've argued that churches should follow generally applicable shelter-in-place orders, that these orders and guidelines do not violate religious liberty. Indeed, we ought to comply with them out of love of neighbor. But if policies single out churches and religious groups, it becomes an entirely different issue, an unconstitutional violation of religious liberty. Over the course of the last several weeks, some government officials have crossed the line. In the case of Louisville, it took a restraining order from United States District Court Judge Justin Walker to curtail Louisville Mayor Greg Fisher's attempt to prevent even drive-in church gatherings. The judge said, quote, "The mayor's decision is stunning, and it is beyond all reason unconstitutional." Consider this. In America, in 2020, comes the threat that they're taking names and they're taking numbers. It's extremely important that all American Christians take note. And in a hurry. I'm Albert Mohler.
ADF, fighting for those whose religious freedom is being violated. Trending now on the Mike Gallagher Show.
The U.S.-based company Surgisphere, whose handful of employees appear to include a science fiction writer and an adult content model, provided data from multiple studies on COVID-19 co-authored by its chief executive, so far has failed to adequately explain its data or methodology. Harsanyi points out partisans have been rooting against hydroxychloroquine for months now. There's really no other way to describe the manic reaction to a drug that has been widely, though anecdotally, said to have therapeutic value against coronavirus. Politicians have blocked attempts to study the drug. The number of shoddy pieces of journalism surrounding hydroxychloroquine, he writes, is just remarkable. A couple of weeks ago, Biden compared taking hydroxychloroquine to drinking bleach, even though millions of Americans take hydroxychloroquine every day to survive. Well, now we know, according to National Review, that thousands of hospitals around the world relied on Surgisphere data to make determinations about treatment and studies. The World Health Organization, the organization I'm assured we must continue funding, halted clinical trial, right? Well, guess what the World Health Organization has now done? They've reversed course, they've resumed studies, and we very well may learn that hydroxychloroquine is helpful in mitigating the damage that coronavirus does. And if that happens and we've delayed the studies, we can probably thank knee-jerk anti-Trumpism for the delays. Once again, lots of deception going on.
Keep up with what's trending. Subscribe on YouTube today. Trending now on the Dennis Prager Show.
America, we have a country to save. And now, here's Larry Elder.
They're willing to take a precinct. Removing the 911 call center won't allow police service in the city. So where is the reasonableness here? Where's the safety of the reasonable community of the city of Seattle? To me, that is absolutely appalling. And I'm embarrassed being a Seattle resident to be even talking about this.
Well, it was unlike any block party I've ever been to. As we approached the precinct that has been abandoned, the East Precinct in Seattle has been abandoned since Monday. As we approached that precinct, we actually witnessed firsthand as about a dozen officers attempted to walk through the blockade to come back to work at the precinct, and saw about 100 protesters flock to them, pick up barricades, and physically force them back out of the zone. And so as we're seeing from the mayor, who's saying, oh, this is a peaceful protest, it's a block party, the police are not supported by the elected officials. They're not allowed to do their job. So they retreated, and that's what you saw in the video we posted on Twitter, is the police load up in vans and move on. The chief of police said yesterday response times in that area have tripled. When they're trying to respond to a rape call, a murder call, it's going to take them 18 minutes because they don't have officers operating out of what should be a police precinct because it's in this occupied zone where these protesters have just taken over. It's complete lawlessness.
Thank you for calling 911. Due to the defunding as a result of the marches against police brutality, there are no officers available to respond to your emergency. At the end of this message, please describe in detail why you are calling, and a member of our team will return your call within 4 to 5 business days. Our services now include social workers, therapists, and mediators. For example, if somebody is robbing your house, we will send out a mediator in 4 to 5 days to kindly ask them to stop. If this is a life-threatening emergency, please hang up and ask your higher being to help you.
888-971-SAGE, 888-971-7243, Larry Elder, ReliefFactor.com studio. The zip poll question I left you with yesterday, because the commissioner of the NFL has now apologized for criticizing Colin Kaepernick, and Drew Brees has apologized for saying, I will never agree with anybody who disrespects the flag, are you now as likely to watch the NFL or less likely? 95% of you said you are now less likely to watch the NFL. Here's the one for today. We'll do the results on Monday. Joe Biden holds a lead over Trump in most polls. Do you believe Trump will get reelected? Yes or no? Go to your Zip app and download the Zip app by searching under Zip Poll USA. Go to your app store, search under Zip Poll USA. Be sure and use my code SAGE, S-A-G-E. I'll give you the results tomorrow. The polls show that Biden is leading in all the major polls. Do you believe President Trump will still get reelected? Yes or no? I'm Larry Elder.
That's enough. Put down the mic.
I want to thank Larry for the job he's done.
All across America, the mic has been dropped.
The Larry Elder Show.